Good morning. Hello, everyone. Welcome back. This is day two of the Equipment Committee. We are at agenda item six to begin our review of the submissions. Are there any comments before we go back to the agenda?
Recording has started.
Okay.
If I could, sorry, I didn't unmute. Could I just ask that the heading on our agenda is changed from Constitution to Equipment Committee, please?
Yeah, I noticed that too, Barry. Okay. So the first submission we have up today is 031 from the classes, really, and it's a housekeeping kind of thing. There are requirements to have measures for each class, and because of COVID, we've had a little difficulty bringing this online. We added this requirement during the 2019 annual meeting. So this just pushes out the requirement for maintaining your designation as an international class due to having or not having an international measure. Does anyone, Marcus, you're the submitter. I don't know if you really have anything to say. If there needs to be anything more said, although it would be good to let us know what the position of the World Sailing Classes Committee was. And then Jorgen, what the Equipment Rules Subcommittee had to say. So Marcus first.
Thank you, Dina. I'm very brief. This has been introduced 2019, and there is no interim period, basically meaning that with approving the submission last year, every class was in breach of the regulation, which obviously doesn't make sense. So we have introduced a 2-year grace period, or that's what we're proposing. And there was a discussion about classes that only have world championships and no other major events every other year. Events in previous years also count for requirements to become a measure. So that might only be a problem in very rare circumstances. And it might be reviewed anyway, depending on how long we have to deal with COVID and not having events, and people have no opportunity to actually go to events to comply with the regulation and become measure.
Okay. Thank you. Jorgen, do you have anything to add?
In Equipment Rules Subcommittee, this was not discussed in that detail. From the IMSC, I can confirm that with the reasoning that Marcus just presented, everybody was in favor.
Right. Okay. Now, quickly, do we want to use the poll system for these submissions? I forgot to ask. It is pretty quick and easy, and we then have a good record of the votes. Is that still all right with everyone? Just say yes.
Madam Chair, if I may.
Yes.
I know it's early and I've started already, but we're only to give an opinion, aren't we?
We are a reporting committee, I believe. We are the reporting committee, so no. We have to make a recommendation to council.
Well, to the way I read the 6.1A1, to give an opinion.
Sorry, Barry. I can confirm that is to make a recommendation to council.
Okay, we take out opinion and put in recommendation. Okay, well, I move that we recommend that we accept this.
Thank you, Barry. Can I get a seconder?
I will second to Dina.
Thank you. Now, would we like to poll?
The poll is live, Dina.
Great.
Oh, sorry, do you want to debate now?
I'm going to ask if anybody has anything else to add. Otherwise, we're going to call the question. Good. Let's go ahead and open the vote, please. I mean, mine came up that the poll has already ended. There you go. Okay. Thank you. Nope, mine still has not come up.
Lina, it should appear as a separate poll. There's 10 votes.
Well, mine's coming up as the poll's ended on both of them. There we are. Now I'm right.
12 votes. There's one missing. Anyone having issues, please speak up. Thank you. Lina, we'll give it 10 more seconds. That will make it 1 minute.
Okay.
That's 1 minute. I will close the poll. Thank you.
Okay.
That's approved, Lina, with 12 votes.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Jaime. Please check your voting and make sure that you're set there, everyone. The next submission, and there are two submissions for equipment, adding equipment at regional games. They are 028 and 029, where as Barry points out, now these two submissions, which are very similar, one is to add the IQ foil and the other is to add Formula Kite. We do not have to make a recommendation. We are just giving an opinion. We are not the reporting committee. So both add the equipment that we have already approved and have submitted and recommended for the 2024 Olympic Games. So this is to add those equipment choices for regional games. Does anyone have anything to add to this discussion?
You know, just a comment, with these regional games, you know, going forward, are they likely to have a keelboat event as part of the regional games?
So I was going to speak about that when we talk about the 2024 events later, but it's a very good question. And the answer is if they would like to, and the certain ones have already indicated that yes, they would have keelboat events added to their slates. They can add other things, but this is, you know, just one of their regulations. They still have the freedom to do what they want and add other events.
But they can add another keelboat to that list.
Yep, they can add to their list. Thank you. Does anyone else have anything to say? Now we have to give an opinion. Would you like to just let the council know that we supported this initiative? And as Murray points out, do we want to make a comment that a keelboat should be added in the future?
Well, I don't know whether we can, because on this submission there's no mention of keelboats, and I think we just need to cover what's in the submissions as is, and that is either kite boarding and also the windsurfing. So I'm not sure that we can add at this stage.
No, we can't add it to this. We can't add it to the submission, but I can report it at council.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, there is a slot there for keelboats when the opportunity arises in the future.
Yep.
Although, why does it say amend regulation 25 and then it says keelboat? Like, you know, on the proposal, it says keelboat actuals.
That's a separate submission.
Lina, just to clarify, if I may.
Jaime, could you?
I'm happy to clarify.
We have 028. We're talking about 028, which is to add the IQ foil right now. And Jaime,
yes. Can you confirm that the submission is on the screen?
Okay.
Yes.
So
you've covered it. It's covered.
Thank you.
Just to confirm, Dina, that the amendment to the regulation is only the inclusion of the IQ foil. There's already a list of equipment for the keelboat. No modification has been proposed through this submission to equipment that could be used at regional games should there be a keelboat event.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
So, can we get a verbal? Do you want to poll, or can we get a verbal opinion? If we'd like to have a poll, I would like Jaime to please put 029 on the screen as well now, so that we can look. This is the submission that adds the formula kite under windsurfing. So we have two submissions that I'd like to, if we're going to poll, that we group together, because I don't think we have anything negative to add here. Our one point of information may be to point out that the keelboat in the regulation might at some point need to be updated.
Well, it just says keelboat in this, okay. At this point in time, we've just got to give a common sense response, and that is that, our opinion is that we support the recommendation, in my view.
So there's a motion to support the recommendation of 028 and 029. Can I get a second, please?
Bruno seconds.
Thank you, Bruno. Do we want to poll, or do we want to verbally acknowledge that we are in a consensus opinion?
I think we should poll.
It's easier to poll. So Jaime, would you please open a poll to support submissions 029 and 028?
It is live, Dina. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. That's everyone has voted. Everyone has voted to approve. Thank you, Dina.
Thank you, Jaime. Okay, the next submission we're going to be talking about is 034. Similar to the submission that was made for 028, I made a submission at the request of the IQ foil class to amend regulation 24.5.3. to consider the IQ foil 85, which we approved as an international class earlier, because that is another name for the IQ foil junior, for it to be added to the list of equipment available to be considered for the Youth World Championships. Their subcommittee met earlier this week or last week, and they invited me to present, and they have some issues with the timing of their championships due to the 2020 event being canceled, them not having a venue selected or a contract for the 2021 event, although they are looking at a late 2021 event for the Youth Worlds. So their timing would be to introduce or consider introducing youth foiling equipment at the 2022 youth championships. Can I get a motion to approve submission 034-20, please?
Can we group with 033-20? Should the IKA be in favor?
Well, I think that two are different enough in our discussions, Barry.
They're both for youth sailing world championships.
Fine. I just thought there might be some difference in the responses.
Well, I haven't put a motion. I've just asked for an opinion from IKA, who Marcus is representing, and to see whether he was prepared or the IKA are prepared to group it with 34-20. But maybe I'll sit back.
The difference is the opinions from the Youth World Subcommittee. So if you don't mind, I'd like to take them separately.
Well, we probably should have known that beforehand. I'm sorry.
I just explained to you that the Youth World Subcommittee was considering delaying the submission for 034. However, they accepted 033. So that's the information. I guess I did not communicate quite well enough. So if you wouldn't mind, because this submission was deferred by the Youth World Subcommittee, I'd like to take it separately.
I'll draw my earlier comment.
Thanks. Can I get a motion to put submission 034 on the table?
Yeah, I'll move
it. Okay. Barry has moved that we approve 034. Can I get a seconder, please?
I will second Zina, but just there is a typo in the submission.
Super. Is it substantive?
No, it's just you speak about 8 meters, Rick, it's a square meter. And just to correct, you refer to the junior division, but it's the youth division in the 8.0 square meters.
Thank you very much. It is the youth division. It is the same equipment with a smaller sail. Thank you very much for pointing out my error. Does everybody understand that? So they have a junior rig that we made a class, and then the junior rig has a smaller rig that makes it the youth rig. Okay, now that we have this on the table, and we only have to give us an opinion, I want you to know that what the youth world's reason for deferring the submission, and they felt that they had not had an opportunity to study all of the available options for youth foiling equipment. So they may have asked or are going to report that to ask the equipment committee to study all available options of youth foiling equipment. I do want to point out that the IQ Foil Junior was evaluated at the trials last year, and that the evaluation panel felt that it met our criteria for youth appeal, and that it did provide a complement to the existing pathways. The trials were not specific to youth equipment, so we were not particularly focused on youth equipment. And the techno class also brought some equipment that they considered to be stepping stone equipment to the trials. They were not, pushy about it. They just brought it to be shown to people, and it is billed as a a rig, a new place where you could take your techno rig and add it to a new board with a very beginner friendly foil, and use it to learn to foil. So we can have no opinion, we can have an opinion, but I think it's a little different. Is there any discussion? No? Do we have an opinion?
If we're going by the list on the chat line, which there is a number.
Oh, I'm really sorry. I left my poll open and didn't open my chat. I will now open my chat. Sorry, everybody. Okay, Bruno, you're first in the chat.
Thank you, Dina. To add to your comments about the trials for Tethered Health last year, indeed, we also had the techno foil present there. It was also tested by the competitors, by the people who were doing the tests. They didn't really like it. That was, I think, the general opinion of it. And based on that, the techno manager has restudied the foil, and they have relaunched a new model that was just coming out now in October. Only a few people have tested it. But the people that I have spoken that have tested it are very happy with it. So I think, yeah, perhaps we should also give them the opportunity because it is a lot cheaper. And that's also important for kids' equipment. They can use the same rig, as you pointed out, as the normal rig they were using before on their big techno. So they only have to invest in a board and a foil. So I think we should, following the advice of the youth committee and say to defer and give it one more year to test against the IQ 485.
Thank you, Bruno. Bill Abbott?
Yeah, I'm wondering if the idea of 034 is to be able to have the foiling equipment for the youth, available for the youth, or is it specifically wanting to limit it to the IQ foil 85? If it's to have the foiling available to the youth, perhaps a friendly amendment would just be to allow foiling equipment and let the choice be made a little bit later, since the events are a little bit further out. I understand it might not be a friendly amendment that way, but it is a fact that the youth people do have to try to do the events as cheaply as possible in regards to that it is supplied equipment and that. And that's the only consideration that I'm wondering about here at the moment.
Thank you, Bill. Jorgen, the next on my chat, but we caught his comment. Kathy?
Yeah, I was more or less kind of wanting to say what Bruno said. I agree with him. You know, I think we should maybe defer it because, so that's fine.
Okay. Alistair, I see you in my chat this time.
Thanks, Dina. Just from my point, I'm sure that we will see the trend will go towards foiling in the youth worlds at some point. But just two quick points. One, when Neil Pride basically informed us that they wouldn't supply the RSX at the youth worlds, BIC did step in, you know, at very short notice. As things have turned out with COVID, obviously we've cancelled the 2020 Youth Worlds. We're now looking to reschedule the 2021 Youth Worlds in December. And I think we really should be giving BIC that opportunity. Certainly, we entered into an agreement with BIC that they would support us through 2020, 21 and 22. Now, with the cancellation of 20 and the rescheduling of 21, we are obviously going to review our contract with BIC, but I think it does make sense, as Bruno mentioned, that rather than simply making a decision now, probably better to defer and then see whether or not BIC also have a foiling option and then bring foiling in down the line. So as I said, I think it is important that any decisions that are made are still subject to the contracts we currently have with BIC.
Yep. Thank you, Alistair. And I do want everyone to point out that, or I want to point out that I, as chairman of the equipment committee, have the ability to put a submission in, and the IQ FOIL was not an international class, so they did not. So this was not in any way my personal opinion or the committee's opinion, and I know that. This was just being able to submit. So I see that Joe would like to speak, and we can entertain that, and then I'm going to go ahead. I think we are getting a consensus. Joe?
Yeah, I also agree with Bruno and Kathy. One of the comments we've had from some of the athletes was, I guess when this came up, the question around why not the option of using the women's equipment like is currently used as well. So I agree that it just needs to be deferred and see what the best option is. Thanks.
Right. I think that's obvious. Okay. Does anybody else have anything to say, or can we move to a poll? Thank you. Jaime, can you set up the poll?
Lina, just to confirm what motion is on the table, it's to defer?
The motion actually is to accept. We can
like to amend that, or shall we vote for that one?
No, well, I would like to have approve, reject, or defer as my options.
Okay.
So if you wish to defer this, you would say defer in this poll. If you wish to accept it as is, you would say accept. If you want to reject it totally, you would reject. So go ahead.
Tina doesn't give us to defer.
I will give it so that it reads vote on an opinion on submission 034. Approve, reject, defer, or abstain. Is that okay?
Yes, that's perfect.
And it's starting now, thank you.
Now the poll is live, okay.
Two more votes to go. One more vote.
We only have 11 votes, folks. Oh, that's not true. We have 12. Okay, we're good.
Would you like me to close the vote now, Lina?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have 10 votes to defer and one abstain.
And one to approve at the top.
Sorry, and one to approve. Thank you.
Okay. All right, thank you. Now, I'm going to move on to 33, which is the kiteboarding, adding the kiteboard equipment. The Youth World Subcommittee voted to approve this. And Marcus, would you like to speak?
Yes, Dina, thank you. Just briefly. So this really is, the equipment was missing in the list, so there needs to be equipment, obviously, for the event that is in the youth worlds, and that is what this submission is doing. From the discussions over the last 2 years since the application or the selection of the equipment for the Olympic Games, it became quite clear that the competitors of the class are very young anyway. We have in the regularly competitors of 14, 15 years old. So the equipment is suitable for youth, junior, and adults. And the cheapest way for M&As definitely is to use the same equipment for regional games, Olympic games, worlds, class championships, class youth events, etc. Same piece of equipment saves a lot of money and coaching costs. So I think there was consensus on that anyway, but it needed to be put in the regulations. Proposal 2 is clarifying that for the kite event, because of the nature of the equipment, registered series production equipment. Everyone can choose from a number of licensed manufacturers. That this equipment needs to be bring your own, which is not a problem because you take it on the plane with you in a 20 kilo bag, and it also saves costs for the Youth Worlds organizers if they don't have to supply it. I think that is all.
Thank you, Marcus. Can I get a motion to put this on the floor?
Yeah, motion to accept.
Okay, can I get a seconder?
I'll second that, Dana. David.
Thank you. Thank you, David Brooks. Do we need any other, do we need any further discussion? If you have comments to make, please put it in the chat so I actually see it or speak up. So that would be there are no further comments. So our poll, Jaime, will be accept, reject, defer, abstain. Jaime, you there?
Yes, Dina, coming up now. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, the poll is live.
Okay, Dina, that's all votes. I'm closing the poll.
Thank you.
We have 12 to approve, 1 abstain.
Great. Thank you very much. Okay, moving on. Our next submission is to give an opinion on 011-2, which is a submission that came from both myself at the Equipment Committee and from the FUM Board class. So, Bruno, would you like to open our discussion here on the advertising code and the maker's marks, manufacturer's marks?
Okay, thank you, Dina. I've changed the equipment here. Perhaps you can confirm you can hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Sorry. So indeed, with the FUM Board class, we have seen in the last years also Formula Windsurfing class and other classes have the same problem, that the manufacturer of the sails have used more and more space in the sail to put their own logo of their sail in. And yeah, they don't fulfill anymore the criteria of the regulations and of the advertisement code. So I think it's necessary to just adjust this and to go back to the situation that is really on the field today. And also the new Olympic class, the IQ foil has the same issue. So I think if we don't act, then everybody could be in problem.
Okay. So to describe this problem a little bit more, the design of the sail is integral to the material, and it is the maker's mark, and it is considered advertising. We then have difficulty placing the national letters and the sail numbers, the boat numbers, as part of that is restricted by the space needed for advertising on the sails. I didn't really explain that well, but Jorgen, can you help me out and discuss this for a few minutes? There's been a lot of discussion in about the racing rules, and it was brought up in the equipment rules subcommittee, and I think we've talked about it quite a lot offline. So I'd like you to bring everybody up to speed.
Okay, thanks, Dina. Maybe I'll put this into two blocks. First of all, it has been discussed in the subcommittee. During their vote, they rejected it because they thought regulation 20.2.6 that requires a clear separation between advertising and national letters and sale numbers was not properly dealt with. However, I have to say that in the last couple of days, further reading into that regulation, but also in Appendix B from the Racing Rules of Sailing, makes it slightly different to my opinion. And that's something I would like this committee to discuss and consider. If you would look into Appendix B, there is a rule B9 that requires the separation from any advertising, but it requires as well the fact that initially they should be black on an opaque white background. Even there is more to it in that section, sorry. There is a requirement that basically there shall be a minimum of 30 millimeters beyond the characters. So taking all the elements into account, you could consider that background delivers sufficient separation from any advertising as suggested. So it really is a matter of going, for me, going through the class rules related to make sure that they have enough, let's say, material around that identification so that we could consider it clearly separate. As some may have seen, there is still another rule in Appendix B, which is subject to a correction, because at the moment, and that was Dina was also referring to, if we look at the pictures, not the design, but the photos of Jaime, then you would see that with that rule in place, you could say that most of the pictures could confirm, apart from the two top left ones. The reason I'm saying this is because, as you can see in those two pictures, these are backgrounds that are, in this case, giving the image of the national flag, which is still can be considered an advertising and is as such not considered a clear separation. In addition, as the rules are today and also with the correction to be implemented, you would not have the authority to go for an identification that is in multiple colors. So I would suggest, if this is going forward, and I clearly support it, that the changes that the office could face in terms of requests are basically a change from, let's say, black letters on a white background towards, let's say, a more dark background with white letters or something like that, but not these multicolor issues that we still face on these pictures. So in general, despite the advice of the subcommittee, I, based on the further reading, I would support this submission. Thank you.
Can you make a motion to that, Jorgen?
Yes, I put the motion to support. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I have a seconder, please? Brian Todd, thank you very much. Okay, so I know this is complicated, and we actually haven't, we did not have time between the equipment rules subcommittee meeting and this morning when the discussions between Jaime and myself and Jorgen and other members of the equipment rules subcommittee were going on. So I just want to take a second and make sure. Jaime, could you put the picture back up of that's here in the submission and go back to the zoomed in version here?
Dina, I'll be happy to clarify if you want also.
Great, you can speak. I just want to make sure that people are comfortable with what they're hearing and seeing.
Dina, okay. Before we go into that, can I just add the small detail I just submitted? There was also in the subcommittee a small discussion whether the no restriction would cover the clear panels, but I believe that is more to be seen as common sense and is something we could in the future still deal with if necessary.
Okay.
Thank you. So Dina, just to summarize, this submission actually tries to bring the sales that most of the manufacturers of the windsurfing brands are producing, where they include the logo and the name as part of the design of the sail, as we can see in the images. The submission addresses all the changes required to allow this within the advertising code. However, it did not address the fact that there's a regulation that says that the advertising shall be left clear of the sail numbers. What we found after the Equipment Rules Committee is that that is dealt by using the background, as we can see here on the images of the left, whereas on the right, you can see that the regulation actually of leaving separation from the numbers refers to the actual characters of the letters and numbers. So on the left, that would be compliant with the regulations. Therefore, we think that there's no conflict anymore, and it only becomes a conflict with a class rule, with racing rules of sailing, which can be changed and addressed through each class rule. So in that regards, it looks like now we are comfortable that the recommendations here within this submission addresses what is currently happening, and it wouldn't create a conflict.
Super. Would anyone else like to speak to this submission? I know it's quite complicated, and I've tried to present all the information that we have.
Helmut is asking to speak.
Helmut, yep. Helmut, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I only want to add to the comments made by Jürgen that one point in the Equipment Rules Subcommittee that was pointed out was that everyone was in favor to bring into the rules what is happening in this world of sailing or in this world of windsurfing. So I think if we can achieve that the equipment is complying with their own advertising code, then it would be it would make sense to approve the submission.
Great, thank you, Helmut. Bruno, very quickly.
Yeah, very quickly. Just to point out that the two pictures of Antoine Albault with the French flag in the background, these are not made on the events of World Sailing. These are PWA events. On the other pictures, you see events from IFCA and from Formula Windsurfing and also from IQ Foil. These are with the white background or with the black background. So these are totally acceptable, and that's what we have been using in the class for many years already. So don't look at the two pictures on the top, because this is Antoine Albault and his PWA friends.
Okay. Anyone else want to speak? If not, may I have a poll put up that is accept, reject, defer, abstain? The motion on the floor is to accept 011-20.
Lina, just to confirm, if the motion on the floor is to approve, then it will show approve, reject, or abstain that motion. Or do you want me to word it as the previous ones were?
I'm trying to word them all the same, if that would be okay. All right. Thanks.
Okay, it's live now, the poll.
Thank you.
Okay, that's all votes to approve, Dina. Thank you.
Thank you. So that carries. All right. Our next submission is 024 to give an opinion about the composition of the Olympic Classes Subcommittee. Marcus, you are the submitter. I'm not sure that this really has much to do with equipment, but it's on our agenda. So Marcus, quickly.
Thank you, Dina. Yeah, this came out of the discussions, not only because of Tokyo has been postponed, but in general, it always will happen if new equipment and new events are added to the program. And we have seen that discussions on Paris 2024, but also on Sailing World Championships, which is the main Olympic qualifier, are happening already a long time, or 2 years, let's say, before before the actual quad starts. So in the discussions with the other Olympic classes, the current ones and the future ones, we thought it would be a good idea to make new equipment for future Olympic Games also part of the Olympic classes subcommittee, so that they can actually participate in the meetings and vote on the matters that affect them. And obviously they should have not a say on games of which they are not part of, and vice versa, classes that are leaving should not have a say on matters that affect later Olympics of which they are not part of anymore. And everyone is in agreement with that. I think it's more a matter of how the Olympic classes subcommittee wants to organize itself. But everyone is in support of that.
Okay, thank you, Marcus. So we are the technical committee. They don't, it doesn't really deal about equipment so much as classes. And I'm curious, does the committee want to have an opinion or discuss the submission? We don't have to. I'm looking at my chat.
This is
Barry. Barry?
Yeah, I think this is a sensible submission because it's going to cover future Olympic classes. And we're looking forward, we're not looking back. At the same time, I think there may need to be a little bit of language clarity to make it a little bit simpler for others to read. But that's just my personal opinion, and I'll leave it at that.
Okay. So that means the committee does want to have an opinion here. So could I get someone to move the submission?
I'm happy to move it.
Great. Barry's moving to approve the submission. Thank you. I'm not sure who that was.
That's Bill.
Thank you, Bill. Okay, Bill, and you also wanted to speak to it?
Yes, I think the equipment committee should have an opinion on this because what these the classes could be voting on is or making decisions about could be equipment. So if we should decide whether we think this is a good idea or not, and I obviously do think it is, because if the next 4 years after, people need to be able to decide on the equipment, and that will, if there are decisions about the equipment, will come through to us. So we should have an opinion on it.
Okay. Kathy?
Yeah, I would feel the same. I think we should support this. I think it's a good thing.
Okay.
Dina,
any other discussion?
Thank you, yep. Dina. Maybe it's worth noting for the committee that obviously, although it's not implicit here in this wording, and the offshore mixed event is included for 2024. There's no class associated yet, so there would be no formal way of appointing someone, but it would be good to recognize that, of course, the Olympic Classes Subcommittee would welcome a representative from the offshore side also into its committee. So I think that is maybe something that you would like to note.
Yep, I can note that in my council presentation. Thank you. Are there any other comments? Okay, so Jaime, we need a poll that would be, again, accept, reject, defer, abstain. And I see the poll is live. Thank you.
Sorry, Dina, I see, I think there's been an error. I need to create the call.
Yeah. Great, thanks.
And it should be live now, Dino.
Thank you, Jaime. Yep.
One more vote to come in. Okay, thank you. I'm closing it. We have all the votes to approve. Thank you.
Okay, the submission carried. All right, now in 6.2, we go on to the Olympic sailing competition and Olympic equipment. The first submission we have is from the Czech Sailing Association. It is 036-20. We are the reporting committee and must offer a recommendation. However, I do want you to note that this would only be considered at council if they first had a 75% vote to reopen the slate for 2024. Our committee has already recommended the equipment in the regulations for 2024. And if we do not have a proposer or a seconder for this, then that would serve to reject this submission. I am not suggesting that we don't discuss it, but I just want to remind you guys of how the process works. So do I have anyone to propose 036-20 from the Czech Sailing Republic? This submission says that if the competition is canceled or postponed again for the 2020 games, that world sailing regulations will be made to revert back to the 2020 Olympics and equipment and replace 2024 events and equipment and delete 2024 events and equipment and replace with 2028. So it would, in effect, move the 2020 slate to 2024 and the 2024 slate out to 2028. Do I have a proposer and seconder? No? That's fine. So now the recommendation to council will come through that the equipment committee has rejected this proposal without it being tabled. Is everyone okay with that? That's fine. All right. So now we're going to move on to 37. Before we that was only 36. Sorry, Jaime. Now we're going to put 37 on. And this one is a little bit more complicated, but again, its purpose is to move the slate for 2024 out and replace it with the 2020 slate. It also goes even further into years to come. So, Barry?
My personal view is that we should be just flatly rejecting all this. We've done all the work and the work, everything's been passed. And let's just move forward, as I've said earlier tonight. That's just my personal view, and I'm quite happy to be stand corrected by everybody.
No. So 36 we've rejected, and 37, if no one's willing to put the submission on the table, it also will be recorded as rejected. Does anyone wish to put the submission on the table for discussion? And I take that as a no. So we also reject 037. Now we can move on. And we are at 030-20 to discuss the criteria and equipment being proposed for the 2024 mixed two-person keelboat offshore. Dan, can I ask you to introduce the submission?
Sure, happy to. Submission 30 has three proposals in it. The first one is the equipment criteria. And the second one is the procedure associated with the selection, particularly the timing. And then the third one is the criteria for qualification events. This is one that we've discussed, you know, among this group in some detail, but I'll go through it quickly. The equipment criteria, there's one change I'd like to make or discuss making is the hull length. I'd like to reduce that to 6.5 meters, just drop the minimum hull length to 0.5 meter. And that is to not exclude at this point one design based on the mini. The proposal is for a one design monohull sloop. I would suggest the hull length 6.5 to 11, but it currently states 7 to 11. So that's an amendment that we'd have to make. I think it would be friendly. Fixed keel while racing, meaning not canting. No foils. This is an area of some discussion. The Figaro 3 is a terrific boat, but it's fairly new to the discipline. And so at this point, most offshore sailing in small keel boats is done on non-foiling boats. And because it's so important for this event to represent the kind of sailing that lots of people do, at this point, for this cycle, we're suggesting no foiling. But the Figaro 3 may well be an attractive option down the road. The spar is either carbon or aluminum, rudder either single or double. OSR Cat 2, I'll ask Will to speak to that in just a moment. And then a fairly simple sail inventory. A mainsail with three reefs, including a 50% reef, which picks up the need for a trysail. A jib with hanks and a zipper reef, a heavy weather jib with hanks and a zipper reef, a storm jib with hanks usable as a staysail, a furling A sail, a furling code sail. And then on the sustainability side, there'd be a blackwater tank and then a minimum renewable power source. So if the boat has, the boat will have to have propulsion to meet OSR Cat 2, but that propulsion capability would be used to supply the media equipment power for the event. So if the boat ends up with a small engine, that could be used to charge the battery. If the boat ends up with electric propulsion, then it would have enough stored energy to power the media gear. So that's basically the proposal for the gear. Will, could I get you to describe the OSR Cat 2 on parts of that?
Sure. I think it's very important that we include it as a Cat 2 because that's where a lot of the racing will occur after the Olympics. So people that want to go in the middle sea race or the fast net race using this kind of vessel would be able to do it if it's built a Cat 2. And the major thing in Cat 2 is Cat 2 consists of a number of sections. It's the structural section where, how the boat is built that is the key part of why we have to have it in there, because that's the hard part to change. If in the notice of race people change whether you have to carry an extra anchor or you have to carry more fire extinguishers or extra life-saving equipment, that all can be added. It's like bolt-ons. That's easy. But structural ones are very hard to change. And what this is going to require for a boat to reach this, which any other boat in Cat 2 would as well require, is you have to get a World Sailing Building Plan certificate. And that is basically that the design is reviewed by an independent third party to ensure that it meets the proper standards. And the standards used in this are ISO standards, which are universally accepted and allow to have a boat that is expected to withstand the kinds of weather that it may run into, not so much in this Olympics, but in any other race that it might go into. It also has a requirement for stability, and the stability is a higher requirement in a Category 2 vessel compared to a category three vessel. The other items are things that the notice of race may decide. For example, because there's going to be a lot of French naval presence close by, maybe you'll say, well, we actually don't need an anchor. Or it might have other requirements, you know, that you have to have additional batteries to provide for the visual, the audio visual equipment that'll be on the boat. So those are things that are still flexible and can be changed through the notice of race. But the key thing is the structural stability of the boat, which would allow it to enter races other than just the Olympics. That's it.
Great. Dan, do you want to continue?
Yeah, I'll continue with the proposal two is the equipment selection procedure. And this one, it's important to note the proposal two says no later than 31 December 2023. As a practical matter, the recommendation would probably have to be substantially sooner than that in order to have time to supply the fleet. And then there may be other tactical reasons why it would make sense to have the tender go out quite a bit sooner, because some manufacturers that would choose to bid might see it in their advantage to propose early and to build a fleet somewhat early so that they could use that fleet and charter that fleet for other activities prior to the Olympic event. And so this is something that will, this gives us the flexibility to do what we think is best. But chances are high that we would want to run this process somewhat earlier. Dean, I might get you to comment on that in a moment.
Okay.
Also in this proposal, the second proposal, there's some other characteristics of the equipment, which is one of them is a bit intangible, but we're saying that we're willing to consider both, you know, larger, high-tech, expensive boats, as well as smaller, you know, lower technology, less expensive boats, but it has to be a good boat. You know, it has to be a modern, attractive boat that represents the kind of racing that's done and that's rapidly growing around the world in this offshore double-handed discipline. It would be important that it be, you know, not only a good boat, but a boat that rates well under IRC and ORC. So these boats have, you know, substantial continuing value and use before and after the Olympic event. And again, the criteria doesn't necessarily lean towards, you know, super high performance. What we want it to lean towards is, you know, modern, attractive, and a good boat, a boat that's fun to sail and that sails well in a variety of conditions. And then, of course, the one design production process needs to be a process that's well controlled, that can yield boats that are equal, but can be further equalized with corrections and rig measurements, etc. Finally, proposal three. What proposal three essentially does is we soften the criteria for use in qualification events. And the goal there is to not preclude a local fleet from being used. So if there's a local fleet that through experience has been shown to be appropriate for racing in the local waters, we don't want to preclude that fleet because they don't meet one of the specific requirements. I think we would also want to allow a continent to qualify by flying their sailors to another area, which I think works. And then the other possibility is I don't think we want to necessarily preclude the use of rating systems for a qualification event. So proposal three basically gives the board the ability to soften the requirements for qualification fleets. So Dina, I guess two questions for you. One is further comments, and then the other one is how you want to handle a possible amendment to reduce the hull length to 6.5.
So first I want to put the submission on the table with a motion, and then I want a motion to amend. That would be okay, Stan.
Okay, can I move it?
Yes, you can.
All right, yep. So I'd move, we put it on the table.
And
I'll second it.
Thank you, Will. I was trying to say that. Okay, and then Stan, do you want to propose the amendment?
Yeah, I'd like to move that the hull length range, that we change it It is currently at 7 to 11. I'd like to say that we change that to 6.5 to 11. So it's a small change in the low end, just not to preclude the mini from consideration.
Can I get a seconder for that as well?
I would second that as well.
Okay, thank you, Will. Okay, so I think we can first talk about the amendment, and then we'll get into the broader context of the submission. Is anyone have anything to say or discuss about the dropping hull length from 7 meters to 6.5? I can tell you the working party, and many of you on this committee were privy to that working party, Kathy, Cedric, Murray. We had 6.5 at the beginning of our conversations. There was some debate about whether that really was what, you know, that small a boat was what we wanted for the Olympic boat. And it may not be what we want for the Olympic boat. That's still to be decided. But we certainly can see that for training and qualification events, the mini class might offer a very suitable example or a suitable training grounds and a suitable boat for qualification. So it became obvious that reducing the other half meter was probably a way to remain flexible and give the most opportunity to continents and nations to participate.
I think we also observed that there's this, the mini is a small boat, it's 6.5 meters, but there's no question that it's, you know, seaworthy and capable of crossing oceans, as has been proven, you know, many times.
Yes. So does anybody have anything else to add about the amendment? Okay, if not, then we can't defer this. It's either an accept or reject or abstain. So Jaime, if you could set up a poll.
Yes, Dina, and it will read the motion on the table, that is to vote to approve submission 030 with the
We want to accept the amendment to hull length to reduce 7 to 6.5.
Mm-hmm. Understood. Just vote to approve amendment to proposal one, hull length 6.5 to 11 meters.
Correct.
Sorry, I thought it was 11.5. Not 11.5. Sorry, 6.5 meters. Sorry.
Yeah, that's what we're saying. 6.5 to 11.
Yeah, it just Jaime said 6.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
Clarify the vote.
It's morning. It's early.
Okay, Dina, that's all votes, has been approved by everyone.
Okay, thank you. So now I would like to, yikes, I gotta find my chat again, sorry. Okay, would anyone like to discuss the submission and the content? How about if we do it this way? Is there any discussion about proposal one? No? Okay. I'm not surprised because many of you, like I said, were part of the working party. So that we have no further discussion of proposal one makes perfect sense to me. Let's move on to proposal two. And is there anyone who'd like to discuss, make any comments to proposal two besides myself? So I'm going to start with this. And what I want to point out is we included in our evaluation criteria that whatever the supplier is, that they have a commercially viable scheme, it's under events 1A, commercially viable scheme to supply the required fleet and spare equipment free of charge to sailors at the 2024 Olympic event. And that they have a commitment to provide boatyard services, maintenance services for the 2024 event. So this doesn't mean that we can't have the fleet available prior to the Olympic event. These are boats that are not going to be destroyed in one regatta, that these boats might not be brand new at the Olympics, but they may very well have had some use beforehand, but they will be free of charge at the Olympic event. So this gives a builder, a manufacturer, or a group that is vying for this tender an opportunity to use and maintain boats and have a way to pay for that fleet. Because that's the big argument that we're hearing, or one of the arguments, you know, that we hear, and one of the challenges to this event is to have fleets of boats available to run the qualifiers, to have fleets of boats for the test event, have fleets of boats for the world championships. And I think it's very important that we point this out in the submission. Jaime, you'd like to speak?
Thank you, Dina. I think it's important to understand that Proposal 1 covers the criteria that describes how the equipment has to look, defined by council. And Proposal 2 sets out how the equipment selection process will be, and it specifies that it will be against evaluation criteria that will be set up by the Equipment Committee and the Offshore and Oceanic Committee, so that they're able to evaluate the different options that meet the criteria from Proposal 1. And that will be approved by those two committees. And it describes how that evaluation criteria and evaluation process what it will take into account. That it will take into account considerations that are relative to the events and the commercial viability. And then also it will add requirements that tenders will have to comply with from an equipment scope of things. Thank you, Dina.
Thank you, Jaime. Bill Abbott, you wish to speak?
Yes, I'm looking at the 1B under the event there.
Yes.
That's really, really broad. We're dealing with trying to supply a boatyard service in an area that is going to be holding the games. That's going to be very difficult for anybody to try to do a cost or a commitment. I'm wondering if that part of the event should not be arranged by the 2024 Olympic event people.
But so, Bill, it's that it won't be charged to the sailors.
I understand that, but this is right now, this is going to be against the supplier of the equipment. And I believe part of that.
It doesn't say that it won't be paid. It's that they have to provide, they have to commit to providing it. They provide the equipment free of charge, but it doesn't say that they're not paid for their services.
So I think this is only just to comment, obviously, that the role of the supplier of equipment not only will be making the boats available, but also will, like with every other supplied equipment at Olympics, take care of the management and the boatyard services during the equipment, during the games. And that is something that comes into effect with a contract with Paris organizers. But Alistair is in the call, and he will be able to explain all the details.
Yes, Alistair, you have the floor.
Thanks, Dina. Yeah, I'm there, good. Yeah, I mean, just to confirm, I mean, the discussions we've had with Paris 2024 are still at relatively early level. They're still putting together their sailing team, but basically Paris 2024 will be responsible for providing the space that's required in the venue, volunteers, all the mooring facilities and so on. But I think we have to treat the supply of the offshore boats in a very similar way that we did to the supply of the Elliots for the women's match racing event in London 2012, where, you know, there was a bosun who followed the Elliots actually during their qualification events and then was present during the London Olympics and was directly responsible for managing that fleet of boats. We can't impose on Paris the responsibility of managing that fleet of boats. It's going to have to be a team from the supplier who is doing all of that. Now, of course, as we get into the detailed planning with Paris 2024, there may well be some areas where Paris 2024 are providing the lead, but I think it's premature to be able to say what's in that. But we do absolutely have to put some of these very clear costs onto the supplier in the same way as we did with the Elliott.
And I think it's important that we note that we're putting this out there now and that it won't be a surprise to anyone who bids for this event. Barry, would you like to speak?
Yeah, I just listening to the comments and summations from various people, etc. I think one of the important things that we should be looking at the moment is the drafting of a tender document. That's our first and initial, that's the initial thing that we must have ready. And tender documentation takes a long time to do and to get it right. And we may have 8 or 9 versions of it. And I think we probably should be looking at that very, very soon. We've now approved, subject to council approving, that we reduce the boat, the overall length of the boat from 7 metres to 6.5 metres. That will go in the tender documentation. Also, some of the things that Alistair said will go in the tender documentation. The tender documentation is the binding paperwork that the builder or the manufacturer or the supplier has to abide by. So I think what we should be doing is moving forward very quickly because we've got the athletes are waiting and they're waiting and they've been waiting for a while now. And we're going to have to, in my view, move this forward a little bit quicker than we probably have done so far.
Thank you, Barry. I think it is stated in proposal 2 that these are the things that will be in the invitation to tender. That's exactly why they are being shown here. We also say that the equipment committee and the Oceanic and Offshore will be responsible for producing that those documents. Anyone else have something to add? Great. Nobody else? Okay. So just to recap here, we have voted to reduce the length of the hull from 7 meters down to 6.5 meters. So our hull length criteria goes from 6.5 meters to 11 meters, and everything else is as discussed here. I guess we are going to a vote. Jaime, could you get a accept, reject, defer, abstain poll together for submission 030-20.
Sorry, Dina, just to confirm, the is table to approve. Do you want defer also in the options?
I do want it in case somebody feels that's the case. I mean, Barry just made a very good point to say we really can't defer. I would hope no one would do that, but I'm trying to be consistent on what our polls are.
I will read submission 011-20. Approve, reject, defer, abstain. Correct?
It's not 011, it's 030.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, that is live now.
Great. Thank you.
Okay, that's all the votes to approve.
Wonderful. Okay, moving on. The last submission, I believe, was submitted by the World Sailing Classes Committee about a change to the racing rules that inadvertently not inadvertently, but was deemed to introduce a change to the rules that some then looked at later and felt was a little out of line. So Marcus, I think you're still here. Would you take the floor and introduce submission 04620?
Yeah, thank you, Dina. So in 2018, I believe, but in any way with effect from 1st January 2021, the racing rules of sailing have changed fundamentally the concept of how it is dealt with trapeze harnesses. The previous rule said that the trapeze harness can be maximum of 2 kg, and class rules can change it up to 4 kg. In the discussion in 2018, the submission made by the RAA outlined that an increased weight of 6 kg is required to accommodate the quick release system and also to allow for lumbar support built into the harness. There's a number of things that have happened in between, and the first thing that happened that with the change of the rule, it changed from a minimum weight changeable by the class rules to a fixed maximum 6 kg weight, which is not changeable by the class rules. And I believe in all the committees where this came up, racing rules of sailing is usually pretty far down on the list, especially when it's combined with equipment rules. And no one really noticed that. And this is not about to say who has missed it, but we all missed it and we have to fix it. The effect of it would be that for every class in the world, for national classes, for international classes, for everyone, they would be able to have trapeze harnesses of 6 kg, which basically is a weight vest, which we deleted from the rules 25 years ago. And this is especially a problem for youth classes. It creates health issues. And for Olympic classes, it would mean that's where basically this mistake has been found in Kiel this year, that people could come with a light wind harness of 2 kg and a heavy wind harness of 6 kg. And this was clearly not intended. During the discussion over the last couple of weeks, it became clear that the conditions have pretty much changed from what the submitter of the original submission believed in 2018. The weights have not gone up drastically. Dimitris has made research on what classes are using. The majority is quite happy with 2 kg. And I think in the meantime, everyone agrees on the principle of that we should revert back to what we had, and it doesn't create any problems with harnesses that are on the market. The current situation that we have where classes feel it is necessary and only a few go up to all the way to 4 kg, most of them are way below, allows that class rules can change that. Given the situation and that the 1st of January is not far, going the other way around to making 6 kg the default changeable by the class rules, first of all, I don't think that would be a friendly amendment because it reverts the concept of the submission. But also it is felt that this is not really necessary anymore, and everyone can happily feed into the 2 to 4 kilo range. If we would do it the other way around, it would require that every class that is not happy with it, including 40 international classes and an unknown number of national classes, all of them would have to have emergency general meetings to change the class rules. Given how late it is in the year and how many classes already had their AGMs this year, this is quite difficult. If we bring it back to what it has been up till the end of this year, then only the classes that really feel that they need to increase the weight by 300 gram or 400 gram need to do something. Okay. I don't know if Jaime has available an overview that Dimitris, I believe, sent on how the situation really is in the world, and if that makes sense to have a look at that.
Okay, well, first, before we do that, now that we've introduced it, I would like to have a motion that we approve 046-20. Can I get someone to move that?
It's David here. I'll approve it.
You'll move the, move the submission.
Submission, yes. Moved it.
Thank you. Yeah. And can I get a seconder, please?
Yes.
Okay. Jorgen? Would you like to speak to this submission, Jorgen?
Maybe in line with what Marcus has already said, I'm not sure whether Jaime can show the pie charts that are at the end of the paper that Dimitris made. But in general, just to give a sum up of the subcommittee meeting, it's totally in line with Marcus's message. So initially, they had the impression that 6 kilo was the way to go for. In the meantime, they admitted that the market didn't evolve in that way, as sailors do require lightweight vests and trapeze harnesses. So yeah, there is no longer a need to go up to that 6 kilo for once. And the second thing, the main concern that he asked to be minuted was, yeah, specify higher weight to be lowered by classes, with the reasons given to be an accommodation of classes with less active class rules management. As you can see from the pie charts there, basically a majority is on that lower limit. So there is an exception left or right going close to the 4 kilos, but never over. So I agree with Marcus's statement that the approach given in 046-20 is the way to go for in terms of reverting to the original wording of the racing rules, stating the minimum limit and allowing others to increase. So the subcommittee was also with a majority in favor of approving that submission.
Great, thank you. Jaime, if you have something to add?
Thank you, Dina. Now, only to note that what's on the table is the submission as it is. So I understand that there's some discussions around how else this could be addressed, but the submission as it is on the table only allows to consider it, and maybe with other minor amendments should the submitter accept them. But right now, this has actually, it addresses the issue, and it is proposed as it is written here.
Thank you very much. Helmut, would you like to speak?
I'm in favor of the submission. However, I would like to point out one very important thing, which is not covered by the classes, is that the section B of the part 4 of the racing rules, it is some kind of class rules for every kind of racing where boats meet without class rules. So quite often you have a rating system that covers it, but there are many, many boats out there. They don't have the option to go into a class rule to accommodate a probable need for a higher weight with regard to the trapeze harness. However, we don't know about this, so therefore we don't believe, and I spoke to some colleagues in the racing rules, we don't believe we should create rules for an unknown problem. So therefore, it is not known to us. I only want to highlight, and this was a point that John Durr wanted us to consider carefully, that everything is covered by our decision, and then the Racing Rules Committee will happily follow the advice from the Equipment Committee.
Okay. Helmut, can I ask? There were a couple of questions that John had sent to me that he wanted answered, and I would like them, I would like to discuss those, and I have to find my piece of paper for a second with those questions. And that was, the first one had to do with,
well, it was basically about what should be the default. Should it be
right?
The default is 2 kilograms and have it optional up to 4 kilograms, or do, shall we amend the submission in a way to say the default is 4 kilograms, and if you want to go lower, then you have to change it through your own class rules. That's basically the main question right. We have to discuss.
Those are the questions that I was looking for. So Marcus, yes, I do have John's email. I just had to open the page. So the questions are that should we be specifying a maximum or a minimum? And we can discuss that all you want, but the point of fact here is this rule had been put forward to leave room for a weight gain that was supposed or assumed might happen again when the introduction to a quick release was made. We found in our literature search here between the time the submissions published and today that there were no instances of companies that are making harnesses that are over 4 kilograms, and that even a brand new harness, which would be at a weight well under 2 kilograms when wet and has and were checked at the test event last year, that they were not exceeding the 2 kilogram limit. There is a class or two that believes they need a little bit higher weight, and those classes are able to change to a higher weight. We know for sure one of our Olympic classes raises the lower limit from 2 to 2.4. So I believe that the submission as presented actually does achieve what the classes need. We've had proof that it does not need to go up to 6 kilograms to accommodate quick release, and classes have the ability to change to what they need. If anybody else has something to say, Marcus, I know you want to speak again, but I want to see if I can give an opportunity to the committee. Does anyone have anything to say first? Great. Marcus, please keep it brief. We have a lot left to do.
Yeah, thank you. Just looking at the last message from John, I think the outcome of the discussion that went on, now the Racing Rules Committee is clearly seeing it that it should be as per submission, default 2 kilogram, and then going up. This requires way less class rule changes than doing it the other way around. And if classes do not have class rules, then either a handicap system covers it, or the other question would be, why penalize everyone for a class that doesn't have class rules? So I think there's broad agreement now for going this way.
Thank you very much. So we have a submission on the table that asks us to accept this urgent submission. And if there's no other discussion, Jaime, please put the poll up approve, reject, defer, or abstain.
It's live now, Dina. Thank you. A couple more votes. One more vote to come in. There's 13 votes. I'm closing it. All to approve. Thank you, Dina.
All right. Thank you. So our next item on the agenda is is an update on Regulation 23. So first we are to note the effects of the postponement of the games. Jaime, you can have the floor.
Yes, thank you, Dina. It's just to note that Regulation 23 that defines the process for reviewing events and equipment is linked to the end of the Olympic cycle, and therefore, due to the postponement of Tokyo, the process of Regulation 23 is therefore automatically also postponed to next year. Originally, Council would have had to select a minimum of 4 events to put under review this year for 2028, and now due to that delay, there's been a working party that has been set up to review how that change on the time and the prime time that we have ahead of 2028 should consider the review of events and of equipment. And it's important to note that Regulation 23 addresses both the review of the events but also the re-evaluation of equipment in relation to the FRAND that happens regardless of the events review. And for the working party, Dina, would you like someone else to address it, or would you like me to comment on it?
No, I would like to hand the floor to Barry to discuss the working party as he has participated over the last couple of weeks. Barry? Barry, are you with us?
The Regulation 23 Working Party, which is made up of people from both events and equipment, has been together now for probably 6 to 7 weeks, maybe a little bit longer, maybe a bit shorter. In that time, we've had, we're up to number 9 version of a draft paper. It's been a lot of work, and it is a work in progress. In other words, it's ongoing. But I'm not sure where it's going to go because, to be perfectly honest, we finish soon, and the work that we've already done, I'd hate to see that put in a too hard basket from somebody coming in and then start all over again. In particular, at 23.6 of the regulation, that's the selection of classes or equipment that needs to be reviewed. And there are some classes that do need to be reviewed. And my feeling is that we need to move quickly. We need to get council, or the new board, I mean, not council, to move this update of Regulation 23 through very urgently, and it needs to be done, in my opinion, by January 2021. Time's against us, and there's no time for procrastination on this. This is a major item on the World Sailing agenda. I'd like to hear what Marcus may want to say about that, Madam Chair, because Marcus has done a huge amount of work on it, and we're grateful.
So the purpose of the working party was to do exactly as Barry has pointed out, and that is to capture the lessons learned from the people currently serving on both the events and equipment committees before the changeover and to make sure that these go forward to the board to continue the process of looking into modifying Regulation 23. During this quad, there was another working party that made a lot of suggestions about things like changing the names of our events and making our event decisions in enough time to process and select the right equipment for the format that the events committee was asking for. There are also a couple other things buried within Regulation 23 that we feel, well, that we've actually dealt with here today. And that is that Regulation 23 and similar, you know, have include the Youth Olympic Games and the Youth World Championships. And we believe that those criteria and those processes need to be completely separated and reviewed as well. There needs to be a strategic plan put into place for Olympic events. We've gone through a very large change reacting to Vision 2020 from the IOC and what they've now published as their new norm. So this working party was put together to, again, capture lessons learned. So there's no submission coming from this working party at this time, but we're trying to capture lessons learned before the committee's change. And then to also highlight that there are some parts of Regulation 23 that really do need to start and can't just arbitrarily be postponed. Jaime, could you show the top part here first, just so that we're aware of which events equipment would be put under review due to our commitments to the EU and review of equipment selection. Even before events are selected, we have an obligation to the EU to begin our review of equipment for the men's skiff, the women's skiff event, and the mixed two-person multi-hull. So that's a board request, and I believe we should have a submission not based on or a recommendation not based on submission go forward to council to make sure that the new board addresses the commitment to the EU for review of equipment and not delay that start. Then I'd like to turn over to Jaime to talk about the timeline with the delay so that everyone on the call is aware of the pressure it will put on the new equipment committee. Jaime?
Thank you, Dina. This is obviously a work in progress, and this is a summary of the timeline coming out of the paper, but basically what it defines is that for the equipment that will be used in the 2028 Olympic year, the decision for the equipment, the selection of equipment, should happen at least 5 years earlier, that is 2023. And so we've been working backwards to see what that would mean. And therefore, it means that next year, 7 years ahead of the Games, we would have to put events under review so that they are decided on May. And then on the following year, on 2022, council would be deciding to retain or select new events and new formats so that the equipment is then selected on 2023. That means that following the review of the event and the outcome of that review, we would have half a year to run sea trials and to run any equipment selection process that is required. In addition to that, is just to note that regardless of what happens to those events that have been highlighted, the mixed multi-hull currently with the NACRA, the men's skiff with the 49er and the women's skiff with the 49er FX, if they were to be put under review, we would require to wait until we know the outcome of that review to be able to run the reevaluation of the equipment that goes for that event. It wouldn't make sense to review the equipment before knowing if the event is going to be retained or not. So we are working on a timeline of what should happen when, and it looks like 2023 we will need to conduct any reevaluate any sea trials that are required on that year. For the following cycles, because we gain 1 year, then we have 1.5 years instead of half a year. But that is just to note that this cycle is obviously constrained due to the postponement of this year's Olympic Games, Vina.
Yep, thank you. This is pretty much a report. This is a work in progress. I don't think we need to have a long discussion, but I do want to know if anyone has any comments that they'd like to make based on this report or based on the paper that was circulated. No? Well, Barry, yeah. I think, oh, Brian, I'm sorry.
I'd just like to, and putting together this report, recognize the work that John Doerr has put into making sure that all the I's are dotted and the T's crossed and such. He's done a great job.
I'm sorry, you don't mean John Doerr, right? You mean John Derbyshire.
Derbyshire, yeah.
Okay, it's the wrong person, that's okay. Just want to, yes, John has done a great job. The working party did get pressed for time. Everything gets delayed until it has to get done, unfortunately. So, okay. Anybody else have any comments? It's very important that we gathered the comments before the committees are dispersed and replaced for the next quad. So that was my purpose in forcing this to happen. And thank you very much for participating, Barry, and everyone else. All right, moving on. First, does anyone need a break or is everyone all right with taking a break when they need it? I think I'm okay with we press on. And so I'd like to just move into the equipment rules of sailing and class rules. Great. I believe I'm to turn over to Jorgen at this point and let him give us his report and discussion. So, Jorgen?
Thanks, Dana. If you allow, I will combine point 1 and point 3 to get my report together with the standard class rules topic, as to avoid shifting between two persons all the time.
Yes, that's okay. Perfectly fine. Yeah.
So basically, as usual, we only have our meeting during annual conference. The most of the topics dealt there are either being separate topics on the agenda, but I would like to point out a few things on working parties and their activity. In terms of the ERS working party, this year, there were no specific working party meetings as we are in the last year of the cycle for the publication. There have been a number of, let's say, editorial amendments, which will be dealt with in a minute. And for the rest, there was a lot of work put in getting the books published. So also for the joint working party with the racing rules, the members were there involved in the completion of the books. We certainly recommend the joint working party ERS-RRS to continue their work in the next quad, because we have seen this as a first step, but the work is certainly not finished yet. So I think going forward, that is something to take up for the new team to come in. In terms of standard class rules working party, we have to say that due to personal professional obligations of the persons involved, there has been little progress made in the last year. We do acknowledge that it would be a good approach for going forward to align the revision of that template with the revision of the ERS. So to make sure that every 4 year cycle, we also have the new template available, which makes more sense for everybody involved. With regards to the path forward to the next cycle, we also were discussing in terms of structure to deal with the class rules We will see the working party dedicated to that later on, which is addressed by one of the staff members. But in order to cooperate with that working party and with staff going forward, we may consider two approaches. Either in the next quad, we reinstate the specific subcommittee on the class rules, or we make sure that the working party dedicated to it has a larger number of members related to not only to the subcommittee, but also co-opted members with, let's say, discipline experts for the different types of boards and boards. In terms of guides and quick references guides, there were a number of ideas put on the paper, which is for consideration by the next team. And last but not least, on the cooperation with the World Sailing Classes Committee, we have noted that for the next quad, it's recommendable to have that committee represented if we go forward with both a subcommittee and a working party on ERS, to have their representative sitting in the two, which was not the case in this quad. So we changed our approach on the way, but I think going forward, it's advisable to have that from the beginning. In terms of the issues that the furlough puts on the different topics to deal with, that has been dealt with by the with staff and also with the appropriate persons in the office. So I would not go more into detail on that one. Are there any, if there are any questions, happy to answer.
I've got one, if it's okay, Madam Chair. Sure.
Please.
In November last year, the 49er class sought to have a leech batten added to its mainsail and its jib. The approval came through after numerous emails and prompts on asking what was happening. I will give the office every accolade in that they tried very, very hard, but they couldn't get anything from the working party that was dealing with this. Can an explanation be given why it took nearly 12 months to get a simple class rule approved?
It is a certainly a good comment to make, Barry. I do not have the answer to the last detail at hand. I'm well aware that there was a large delay, part of it being the situation, part of it, let's say, digital environment, and then there is a third part, which obviously is the reactivity of the structure as a whole in terms of discussing the topic. I think you made a good point in terms that we need to, let's say, define a better kind of KPIs to make sure that we deal with it in a timely manner. But it is what it is. I cannot revert time. I totally accept your comment, and I cannot do more about it at this stage.
Well, all I ask is we have what's called email, and we're asked to respond to things by email. And in my working life, if I didn't respond to an email to a request, I was pulled before the CEO and said, why didn't I respond? Now, I have all the emails that I sent and not one response back. And I find that, to be honest with you, it's not good for our sport, I don't think. You know, guys were left waiting and waiting and waiting to find out whether or not. And it was only that I got to Jaime and he rushed something through. And it shouldn't have been put to him. It should have been put to the subcommittee or the working party responsible for it to act on that thing. If they're not going to act on it, don't be on the working party. I'm sorry to be so blunt, but I was pretty upset about this because I was the one that was copying it continually from the 49er executive and also from the sailors. Why? It wasn't my fault. I'd done everything that'd been asked for, but others let me down.
Point taken.
Point taken. Thank you very much, Barry. We'll we'll try to prevent that in the future by having a few more safeguards in place.
Just to comment, Dina, in yes. general, obviously this year has been challenging, and this year the way we proceed normally with class rule changes, and this will be addressed later on in a different agenda item, but just to highlight obviously that we have had to lean more on our volunteers and all of you and all of the working parties, one of them addressed to look into how we can move forward with class rule changes. Not always when we receive a request, it is a straightforward, it opens mm-hmm. a debate. We have to go back and forth and discuss the wording, how it affects other rules, how it affects the changes, especially with Olympic classes. We have to also to see how that, if the board needs to be aware of it, if it implies changes to the notice of race to Tokyo, et cetera, et cetera. So obviously in this case, there were also, it affected also the image of the sales on how the branding could be affected for Tokyo. So there were a few considerations that required to follow due process and get the equipment rules subcommittee involved in the process. And that might obviously add to the length of the implementation of the rules. But hopefully we think that by the proposals that will be discussed later, we'll be looking to having a more streamed way of dealing with class rules. Thank you.
Well, I'm not going to go on and on and on about it, but as I said, it was in November 2019 it was first raised. And Jaime, you'll remember me making a phone call from New Zealand about it. And then I got an email out to you as quickly as possible with photos, et cetera, et cetera. COVID didn't come into effect until March, so that was 5 months. And really, I would have thought that we would have had something, because I had other emails to say, oh, we'll look into it.
Well, I understand, Harry. I understand, although I also appreciate that.
Leave it as it is. Don't worry about it.
Thank you. But it's good to note that the final wording was not the originally proposed. So at the end, the review process achieved its goal. So I'm happy that we followed it. So thank you for that.
Okay, thank you. And thank you, Jorgen, for your report. And now we're going to move on to Alistair, I believe, is going to give us a presentation about the preparations for 2021.
I think we rather, just before that, just to comment that the equipment rules, in case the group is not aware, but obviously we have published the update and it's been available. The classes will need to implement the changes. There's a summary, just for the record and for those watching and the classes, there's a summary of the changes posted online and also a guidance as to which sections of the class rules they will have to address. And also to note that there's been a minor correction that didn't require approval because it was just an update of two images in the document, but all that has already been implemented and posted online. And just before we jumped into Alistair, we had that item in the agenda 8.B that refers to the class rule changes working party, if we want to cover that, and to note the class rule changes that have happened this year, which are on the screen, and that's it.
I think that's fine. We'll try to do this quickly. Henrik?
Yeah, so basically there have been changes over this year. So despite the fact that most of us weren't followed, we progressed quite a lot of class rule changes. Regarding to the topic Barry and Jaime just raised about the class rule changes procedures, there's a working party in place working on a standardization process of the procedure to make it basically easier for the office, easier for the equipment rule subcommittee, and obviously easier for the classes to deal with class rule changes, submit like a standardized document, and then going through a simple process, so everyone knows what to do next and what are expected deadlines or how fast can something get progressed. And basically that's the goal for the upcoming months.
Thank you, Henrik. Yes. And I believe Bruno is asking me a question. Will there be a printed version of the ERS as there has been in the past? I don't know the answer to that question. Does the staff?
Hi, Dina. We have not provided any printed versions. I do know that the RRS have worked a deal through some sort of Amazon, but this one has not been considered yet. It is available online. It will be available through our apps, like with the current version, but there's none yet printed.
Okay. Thank you very much. So now we're going to move to Alistair. Alistair's report on the Olympic event preparations. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Dina. Just to run through, I guess, some key points for this committee. First of all, starting with, I think, the very good news that from the IOC point of view, Tokyo 2020 and all of the international federations, you know, there is a working assumption that the Olympic Games will take place next year. There's no work going on anything else. So I think the really positive news is that everyone is moving forwards to fully implementing the games next year. We've basically got the new notice of race, ready to get published, and our goal is to publish it in the first week of November. I know a lot of work has been done around the equipment regulations as well, and thanks for Jorgen and for Demetrius and Jaime and for all the people who've been working on those. But we'll basically be publishing the notice of race very shortly, which I think will give a lot of sailors, you know, the confidence that the games will take place next year. Tokyo 2020 has undertaken a complete cost and complexity review. Obviously, they've got enormous additional costs with the year delay, but the good news is that those cost cutting exercises that they've carried out will not affect activities on the field of play, didn't affect the athlete experience in any way. What they're really trying to do is look at non-sport areas where costs can be cut. So the overall number of cars that are available, for example, but also the way the Olympic Games are branded and things like that. In terms of sailing, one area that we're still looking for clarification on is how many measurement tents we'll have. We've made it clear to Tokyo 2020 just how important the whole equipment inspection process is. And so we're pushing to not have any changes there, but that is one example where we are a little bit concerned at the moment, and obviously keen to ensure that there aren't any changes, or if there are, they make no difference to the way we carry out our work. I think the one unknown really is what type of COVID countermeasures will have to be in place next year. That really is an unknown at the moment, and the IOC are working on various different scenarios. They've got a base case scenario where, by and large, there may be some social distancing, but clearly they're also working on plans where there's much bigger problems, or perhaps problems in certain parts of the world and how they deal with bringing athletes and officials into Japan. But as I said, that is one area where Tokyo are not yet sure what will happen. But something, again, and something maybe for some of the members on this committee to think about, is that what we are going to have an opportunity to do over the coming months with Tokyo 2020 is to share our best practices. So what actually is happening at sailing events at the moment in terms of the way we are able to do equipment inspection, in the ways we're able to hold jury hearings and team leader meetings and things like that. We really need to be able to share how we think we can deliver the sport in 2021 if there do need to be countermeasures in place and social distancing in place as well. So I know, Jaime, we will be involving you in that process, just to make sure that what we think is the right way of doing things next year is the way it ends up, rather than a more generic model being sort of forced upon us. Maybe straying away a little bit from equipment committee areas, we've not quite finished the qualification process for Tokyo 2020. By the time COVID hit, we had completed most of the qualification events, but we still have qualifiers that need to take place in Europe and Asia and Africa for those remaining continental qualification places. And obviously we are concerned that those events may not be able to take place. For example, the RSX Europeans are scheduled in November in Portugal. They'll be the final European qualifier for both the RSX men and RSX women. But if it is impossible through travel restrictions for all of the eligible teams to be able to compete in that event, then it will not be able to be an Olympic qualifier. So I think over the coming months, there are going to be some challenges as we're trying to finalize those last remaining qualification events. The good news is we have until June the 1st next year to complete them. But certainly looking at the situation in Europe right now with COVID, that could create some real problems. Dina, I'll stop it there. There's more that I'll present to the council over the weekend, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Alistair. Does anyone have any questions for Alistair? I think seems like there's some events happening in my own area. There's some events happening and they seem to be successful. But I do know that many areas in the world are restricted and no sailing at all is happening. So I think it'll be a little while till we have a final result, but hopefully positive. But hopefully we're moving in a positive direction. Thanks, Alistair. Does anyone else have any comments or questions for Alistair? Great, let's move on. Thanks, Alistair. Okay, well, this section of the meeting, point 10, is on the 2024 Olympic equipment and Olympic class implementation of the Olympic equipment policy. I'm going to hand this over to Jaime.
Thank you, Dina. Just let me know if there's questions, as I cannot see the chat right now at the moment, but what I will do is describe briefly the Olympic equipment policy to start with. And as you all know, this was implemented last year following policy decisions from Council. And as defined in the Olympic classes contracts under the policy, the class associations and the copyright holders are responsible for coordinating the implementation of the policy within each class. And therefore, they must ensure that there are regular opportunities for any qualified interested party to become a manufacturer of Olympic equipment. And they must also, the classes must ensure that there's sufficient testing and integrity of the equipment. From our side, from the office, we've been discussing informally the implementation of the Olympic equipment policy with each one of the Olympic classes. We know that there's some classes that are further advanced in establishing and updating their processes, and others are still in the early stages. And given the impact of COVID on our industry throughout this year, we haven't been very strict on our approach to date. However, we are currently working on a process by which we will formally engage with all the classes individually to get an understanding of what the intended timelines and processes are. And then, taking into account the input from the classes, we will put together a timeline as to how we will monitor the implementation of the policy across all of the classes. And that timeline will include key dates, such as the date by which the classes need to include in their class rules that specific equipment items must be from World Sailing approved manufacturers, and therefore from manufacturers that have been appointed in compliance with the policy. And that is for that one. If there's any questions on it, if they are of legal nature, I will have to refer them offline to Kendall, Dina. But if there's any questions at this stage.
I don't see any questions in the chat, so continue.
Thank you. On changes to the building specifications for the current Olympic equipment, which is not all showed there in the image, but we've only been informed of the ongoing intentions of the NACRA 17 to review their rudders, and they will continue to evaluate a change to L rudders that they're testing and continue to test. This won't happen until after the implementation wouldn't happen after this Olympics. And also, they are now also considering evaluating changes to the current T rudder, but removing the torpedo section in the center line of the rudder. The 470 hasn't taken a decision yet, as far as I recall, or they were still debating whether they would move forward to carbon masts. On the other classes, there's been no reported changes. We know that the 49er has changed some specifications on the spars, and also due to the process of selecting new manufacturers, and also are looking now into tenders of new cell makers. But Barry can answer any question on that side, but if, unless there's any questions specific to this item, I will move forward.
I see no questions in the chat, so I would continue.
Thank you. The next items on the agenda are to note the progress of the Olympic equipment that, of the new Olympic equipment that will be in 2024, and those are the IKA formula card, the IQ foil, and the process around the equipment selection for the mixed to persons keelboat offshore. On the IKA, I would like to hand this over either to my colleague Hendrik as measure of the class, or Bruno, who's part also of the class technical committee, just to note the updates on the registration process. Dina, if that's okay.
That's okay. Hendrik, are you prepared?
Always.
Yeah. Why don't you go?
So basically, yeah, the class routes, considering the inspection of the manufacturers, or this year. So the year started, yeah, quite turbulent, but we managed to inspect all manufacturers of foils and kites virtually or on site. So this was done in time. The registered equipment is available for purchase now and is already raised. So that's the status from my side. If Bruno, I think like Marcus is also still in the call, if you ask him about a bit more details, but I think that should be for now.
Dina, just as just to comment that they received 23 different, applications to be registered from a total of 23 different manufacturers, six of them for kites and 17 for hydrofoil systems. And then obviously there were, from all of those, there were 15 that were approved and 3 that were rejected, if I understood correctly.
Okay. The only question I want to ask the IKA, and I think Marcus is still with us, is when is, to just explain to the committee very briefly, when is the next period for registration of equipment open?
The next cycle is the next Olympic cycle, so we are updating now the dates in the class rules. It's a rolling 4-year process, so it will be in spring. In theory, everyone can register already now for the next quad, but it doesn't make a lot of sense. So the normal procedure will be that the registration deadline will be in spring 2024. And then the subsequent factory inspections, approval process, etc. And the equipment will then be on the market by June 2024 and eligible to be raised on the day after the Olympics 2024. So it is the 10th or 11th of August 2024, I believe.
Thank you, Marcus. So if one of the unsuccessful registrants wanted to come forward now and add his equipment, it wouldn't be eligible for racing until 2024, but you would still consider them?
Well, we will take the registration as outlined in the class rules, and the next eligibility date then is in 2024. So for Paris, there can nothing be added to the list anymore. This is to give M&As the safety to that the equipment that they're purchasing is what will be eligible, and that you're not getting last minute additions and everyone has to buy something new.
Yep, just wanted everybody to be clear. Thank you. Aimeek, why don't you continue into the IQ foil?
Thank you. Sorry, I had here the summary, forgot to put it, but there it is.
Oh, okay.
If you want to just look at it, but
go ahead and
anyway.
Speak. You can speak to it.
No, it's just what we mentioned. There were 23 applications, 17 of hydrofoils, 8 were not considered to fulfill the application, and the registered manufacturers are available in the class. And well, basically everything else has been already mentioned. For the IQ foil, just to comment that the World Sailing inspected the board where they manufacture the boards and the fins. We've been very much involved with the class with implementing quality control systems, and they have taken an active lead on this, transforming all the databases into QR codes that are applied into the equipment. We obviously, this is a work in progress. The location of those stickers needs to be improved, as currently you have to de-rig the equipment, so it doesn't really allow for equipment event limitation to control on site. But they have implemented, and let's see if this works, different tests that they are applying to every single equipment item, uploading that information on the database, and then World Sailing is able to access it and evaluate, which on time will allow us to evaluate the trend and how the equipment is within those tolerances or not. Then also following the let me just, if I may, share something else, which is the report from the Europeans, where it shows the challenges that the class is going through in terms of equipment and what we saw once it was being tested. I am sharing now the report from that event that was produced by the technical committee of the event. Skipping the side of the participation numbers in terms of equipment, what we are referring to is small changes that the manufacturer will have to implement so that we can actually access the inspection of those stickers without having to remove the foil mast. There were some breakages at the first event of mast, and also some collisions of boards hitting each other, and some also foil mast breaking. But overall, the manufacturer is working in a few minor details, trying to update and improve a few areas where the mast is connected to the board. They want to reinforce that section, and also they want to reinforce a minor section of the sleeve of the sail. That is so far on the IQ foil. And next, unless there's any questions on this that anyone would like to address.
There are no questions in the chat, so I think you should continue.
So just before I move now to the offshore, it's most of it has been covered with the submission that addressed the criteria and the different proposals. But just to maybe highlight on the screen what the timeline would look like, that proposal in the submission, actually, as Barry said, that we should be working towards having an invitation to tender. Once that submission is passed, that would be indeed the next step. And what we foresee is that we would indeed need to select the equipment ahead of the end of 2023. We have been in discussions, as you know, with equipment manufacturers and the industry. They were all suggesting that they would require, or ideally they would have, 1 year to produce the equipment, which also would allow World Sailing, the Equipment Committee, and the Oceanic and Offshore Committee to address the quality control and evaluate the production of the equipment across 2023 for delivery early 2024. And working backwards, what we foresee is that we should aim to have a tender document where we define the evaluation principles and the criteria on how we would be evaluating the different equipment options that meet the criteria of this submission, approved by mid-year next year, so that we can publish it and then have a year and a half to evaluate the options and run tenders if necessary, etc. So this is just to highlight that draft timeline that we would be considering.
Great, thank you, Jaime. So the working party and some of the leadership here from the equipment and oceanic and offshore committee have recognized the urgency and are well aware of the timeline. Barry's asking me a question. Are we as the equipment committee to receive a copy of the offshore timeline? Sure. I think we can circulate this. It is a draft. It's not in stone, but it's something that both Dan and Jaime and I realize is going to be critical. Any other questions? Super. Link, go ahead.
Thank you. Just to comment that link to this, we also as an update, or not an update, but to discuss a bit further the discussions around the progress of the mixed two-person offshore keelboat selection process. We have also discussed how we would like to see multiple manufacturers, multiple fleets thriving throughout the years. We offered to put this on the table just to discuss the different opportunities and to give an update of how different events are implementing this discipline. And just to highlight that for the traditional Olympic events, like Palma, Hears, Peel Week, and the other ones, they are working together to have supplied equipment provided to the athletes. Currently, they are inviting any supplier of equipment that, that can provide at least 6 boats to their event for 2021. So they could have potentially an event where they have 6 L30s, 6 DL30s, 6 J boats, whatever fits, whoever is available to supply that equipment. And they would run the event with qualifiers with that everyone, all those fleets will be sailing separately. And then the final, it will be one of the available fleets where those qualified compete. We also see that different events that like the where world sailing is involved could actually allow to promote different equipment. And obviously there's a broader discussion of whether one event, the qualifiers will need to be with the same equipment of the Olympics, etc. But this is just to show that there's a bunch of opportunities there to see different equipment tested in the process.
Jaime, can I ask a question, please? Yeah.
Yes, please.
Just on the mixed offshore circuit, what is the reason and the logic behind the European circuit, North European winter, South European summer?
Not sure I follow. Can you repeat that, Jürgen?
In the mixed offshore circuit World Series, halfway the table, there is stated for the venue European circuit, Northern Europe in winter and Southern Europe in summer. Is there a specific reasoning behind it?
Sorry, so this table shows the different initiatives on that are currently happening around this discipline. As I mm-hmm. mentioned, the traditional Olympic regattas in the top, then the Offshore World Championship, the World Sailing Classes. But there's also an initiative that it's from that is not. I think it hasn't been formalized yet, but there are there's an ambition of creating a mixed offshore world series, and this just mm-hmm. reflects the intentions of that group, that they are planning towards having a European circuit, working around that proposal. This has got nothing to do with world sailing. Sorry?
Jürgen, please continue.
I was just wondering whether there was a logic in terms of Northern Europe in winter versus summer yeah. and the other way around. So that was the question.
That's right. Cool. Okay. Kathy, did you want to speak?
Sorry, yes, I just think it must be a typo. Should it not be the other way around, that it should be, you know, Europe in yeah. winter and Northern Europe in summer? I think it's just a typo, I think.
Yeah,
I'd imagine.
Possibly.
I'll be happy to send, if I haven't done that already, to send the promotional material that the people involved with this circuit have prepared with everyone.
So this is to illustrate that there is a lot of activity happening, and people in the world are excited about it, about the mixed two-person keelboat offshore, and Jaime, if you're finished, I would like to introduce Larry at this time. So Larry Rosenfeld, is your microphone live? While they're working on that, as I explained, there's a bit of leadership working on event activity as opposed to equipment. And over the winter, Dan, Honey, myself, Matt Allen, Jaime, Alistair, Sarah Kinney had a number of conversations about what amounted to the fact that no one would be available to represent this discipline on the Olympic Classes Committee, and that with a delay in supporting equipment and selecting equipment, we wouldn't have a situation that was similar to the other One Design classes. So we started to work on a association and have actually 2 weeks ago launched something that is called the offshoredoubles.org. And through our connections and other work with the Sailing Yacht Research Foundation, Dan and I were familiar with a fellow by the name of Larry Rosenfeld. And we don't really have time to do a full introduction, but Larry agreed to become the executive director for the launch of this association. And I don't want to steal any of his thunder. So Larry, I'm going to hand you the floor. I'm assuming you're with us. So do we have Larry in his microphone live? I see him in my group.
He appears to be, Lena.
I can't. But we cannot hear. Yeah, Larry, I can't hear you. This is unfortunate. Your microphone's on, but I can't hear you. Is he muted by the system?
No.
Well, Larry, let us know when you get in, and we'll work on this. Larry is very good at computer literacy. So that is one of the big reasons why Stan and I approached him to take this over. So what's happened so far is the association was launched right about 2 weeks ago. And there were announcements made, some press releases. We got a lot of publicity from both World Sailing and Scuttlebutt, and some of the sailmakers around the world have allowed the use of their distribution lists. And in the course of the 2 weeks since this association was launched, we now have over 1,000 members. So if you haven't already heard of offshoredoubles.org, or you haven't already seen the website, I encourage you to take some time and take a look at it. As you can see here in the slide, the mission is really to promote all of double-handed offshore sailing. Yes, the Olympic is part of mixed, is part of offshore doubles, but it isn't 100% of the focus of the association. We believe that this is one of the fastest growing segments of our sport, and that it serves as a needed area of growth in sailing around the world. We recognize that other circuits and other offshore organizations exist. We have been talking with them. If you look at our advisory board and the pictures thereof and the names, you'll recognize many people who have been involved in the sport and are offshore related.
Lena, Stan, yes. Is also willing to speak on this topic.
Great. Stan, I'm happy to have you continue.
No, I think you hit the highlights, Dina. That's perfect. The I've known Larry, you know, for decades. We've raced 505s against one another and navigated maxi catamarans and maxis on transoceanic and around the world races against one another. Larry's very strong technically. But the thing that, and as Dina mentioned, we wanted to have an organization to represent this discipline at World Sailing and elsewhere. But the thing that I think astonished all of us is the organization was introduced just 3 weeks ago, and there's already over 1,000 members in 55 countries. So I think that really does provide an example that this is, in fact, one of the fastest growing disciplines.
Great. If we get Larry in at some point, that's wonderful. I encourage you to go look at the website. The content is growing, it will continue to change. And I'm really enthused, and I'm happy to take any comments or questions at this time. Yeah, Daniel tells me that he's working to bring Larry in. So let's give it another minute. The other thing Bill, you want to speak? Why don't you ask a question before I add another piece of information? Go ahead.
Yeah, before this is a comment, the offshore doubles, except that it may be part of it. And that is, now that we're this far along to 2024, has there been any one piece of equipment that is coming forth to be ahead of the others in the amount of use, the amount of the number of boats that are in different events? And does that, if there is one, does it actually fit into our requirements pretty closely?
So Bill, I don't really know how to answer that. I mean, there's been a huge uptick in the number of double-handed certificates that ORC has printed this year. Here in a pandemic, when the rest of their certificates have dropped off, the double-handed side of their certificates has grown. In my own area, we have had double-handed racing in not only one design, but also under rating rules racing. Every offshore event on the calendar has had a double-handed division. Now, from that, would I say there's one boat that is taking the lead? I don't believe so. I don't believe that is the case as yet. I see that Larry has rejoined. Larry, can you hear us?
Can you hear me?
Okay, I can't. Oh, Larry, yes, I hear you. There you are.
Go out and come in again, and then now it's working. So I'm very sorry for holding everybody up, but thank you for the nice introduction. You can hear me, I assume?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
great.
You can. All right.
So, well, go ahead, Dina.
Well, maybe you can better answer Bill Abbott's question that he had just a minute ago while you were off. And he asked, as you look at events around the world, is there one piece of equipment that seems to be taking hold and being used more often than not?
Well, I think so far what I can see is not so much. There have been some early work with the L30 and the Eurosaf doubles worked quite well with a small fleet. But you know, we think that there's lots of options out there. I've been talking to the manufacturers and boat classes a little bit, just beginning to, and I think there's a lot of interest. I think it's important for us as a discipline to keep the keep as many options on the table as we can to begin with, to see what the possibilities are and to see what will be supported around the world, because as we know, one of the issues with the offshore doubles is the the boats and getting the boats to and from events. So we want to make sure that we have the most viable solutions out there.
Okay. Sorry, Larry, to cut you off now that you finally got in, and I know you've been listening all day.
Okay. I just wanted to highlight, I think we're, I don't know if you said this, Dina, but we're now, as a result of tremendous support from everybody at World Sailing and others, we're now at 1,100 members from 56 countries that are recognized MNAs in all six continents, and 13% of the members are women. So we're very, very pleased with the reach that we've gotten in just 2 weeks. And we're continuing to work this week. We just put out a press release yesterday about it to see if we can get more.
Great. You did bring up one other area that I'm briefly going to touch on. And a lot of the feedback we had talking to some of the sailors who are starting to join the association is, of all the Olympic disciplines, this is one of the ones where in a mixed team, you must be equal partners. So there will be, I think, a great opportunity for the increase in skill levels of women offshore sailors and women sailors in general due to this event. So I'm really pleased and excited about it. If there's not any other questions, I know Will Eppol has to be off the call very shortly, and I wanted him to get to he and Kathy to do the safety report for the paper that they have prepared. So are there any other questions before we move to item 12? Wonderful. And Joe, you don't have anything you'd like to say? Nope. Okay. Thanks, Larry, and okay. We'll talk to you soon.
Thank you. Okay.
So, Will, Kathy, we have a working party report that you circulated, and I wanted to give you a minute to discuss the paper and then to receive our safety panel reporting figures. So, Will?
Okay, thank you, Dina. So we've been working on this in reasonably short notice from basically August, and have spent quite a bit of time looking at what's already been out there. And so there's been quite a few studies. Australia's done extensive work on it. Our own medical commission did. And so there was some items to start working with. I think one of the things that you realize when you start to look at it is how much energy that the increase in speed is putting into boats and to people. So when you go from basically 20 knots to 30 knots, you go from maybe 4 times the amount of energy to 9 times the amount of energy, because the energy is basically the mass or the weight of the person or boat by the speed squared. So it's a lot of energy as you go up in speed. And so it's an important thing to start dealing with, particularly with all the foiling that's going on. The other thing that came forward is that there's a lot of class associations already that are dealing with this and dealing with it in a reasonably effective way. But it does vary all over the place. So there is a need to, I think, to bring it into some sort of control. We have, just hold on, just got to find my paper again here.
Let me know if you would like it on the screen.
Yeah, why don't you stick it up on the screen and I'll keep going through this. What we found out something wrong with my addition of it.
Can you just confirm that it's up?
Yes, I see it.
Yep. So we found that speed is obviously the factor. Boat weight is something to do with it, but mainly just with collisions. Speed is really the factor in dealing with the injuries. Foiling obviously adds to this because you've got a foil in the water, which is sharper normally than most bows. And that you can reduce the injuries by adding obviously protection to people and to protection to boats. We also found that in some associations, they vary the protective equipment that people can use depending upon wind speed. And there's a fair amount of flexibility in terms of the equipment they wear. A lot of people choose their helmet, not for the safety, but how they look in it. So their first thing they do is put it on and look in the mirror. Our recommendations are pretty straightforward. That the classes are really the ones that have to deal with this. They know the issues that they're dealing with. It's very hard to come up with one rule that would say that you have to wear a helmet when you go over 15 knots. So what we're saying is that it's up to the classes. They have to review what is required, either as additions of equipment on their boat, like padding in a particular place, or on their boards. And that they should be required to report to World Sailing in their annual report what they're doing on the protective equipment and to include this in their class rules. So that going forward, World Sailing would require this as a requirement for them to report it. And we would start with boats and boards that go over 20 knots first, because they're obviously the ones that are potentially at the greatest risk for our sailors. So that's basically it, Dina, that we want the staff to require this in their reports, and they would first focus on the faster boats.
That's great. Everything.
Okay.
Kathy, so, Dina, do you have anything you'd like to add?
No, I think Will is very eloquent. He said it all.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Good. Well, thank you both for jumping on that at short notice. I appreciate it. And I do agree with the recommendation to add it to the class reports, and we'll work on seeing how we make that happen. Jaime, would you like to tell us about what work has happened in the office from the safety panel?
Thank you, Dina. And also to add to the report, just to note that It is good to note that the current standards that we use for helmets are actually the result of other sports. We use kayaking and snowboarding standards that we show in our class rules. It is important to note, without noting the brand, but we are working closely with a safety gear manufacturer that is actually implementing a sailing protocol to define a safety protocol for actually helmets, and that is the first step to come up with a sailing standard. So that's actually something where we will like to be involved, and we see that it's very beneficial to work on the awareness on what the differences between the different specifications and the different norms out there, what it really means. And once sailors actually know why one norm has one standard and why another one is actually for another sports, it becomes relatively quite straightforward and the natural choice to select the one that has been taken into account the sailing protocol. So that is something interesting that we'll be working on safety awareness. From the safety panel, as you know, last year we included in the regulations that classes will require to submit that they have declared in the annual report that they're not aware of any incident that hasn't been reported. As you all know, we have the incident reporting incident portal, where either classes event organizers or sailors themselves can report the incidents that have occurred. And we've continued to update that, and the list is available on the website. If there's a report related to one of those incidents, it's also published there and made publicly available. And there's nothing particular to report on that, Bina, other than either due to the lack of activity or due to the lack of knowledge. There hasn't been many reports this year, but we have requested it and we have included it already in the annual reports for the classes. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Is there any other comments related to this segment of the agenda? Okay. Well, thanks, Will, and I, you know, have a great meeting. I'm going to now go back to point 11, which is our equipment controls and policies, and hand the floor to Jaime.
Thank you, Dina. Just to confirm, yes, okay. Let me just check what is first on the agenda. Thank you. Can you confirm that you can see this screen?
Quality control strategies up on the screen, yes.
Thank you. So as you know, this actually addresses the quality control strategy from World Sailing towards Olympic equipment and the Olympic classes. The supporting paper has been prepared for actually this meeting and also for the Olympic classes subcommittee meeting, and it's been distributed and made available. So we have to take it as read because it's quite long. It's actually 5 pages and then a few appendices, but the debates around it have been extensive, and we've been discussing with different classes. It has been already circulated and discussed with all the affected classes. It's important to note that it affects only those that will take place in the 2024 Olympics. And the objective is to implement a quality control system for Olympic equipment classes to ensure that the equipment is built in strict accordance to the specifications, and that there are systems in place that allow to identify alterations. As we all know, sailing is a technical sport and it's necessarily very equipment related. And whether a class aims to promote equipment development within their rules and the tolerances within the rules, or whether if a class aims to have all competitors using the same equipment, in either case, equipment performance optimization is at the core of high-level sailing. We have stressed that due to the different models that the Olympic classes have in the interaction with equipment among the Olympic classes, the scope of work and the structure of the quality control strategy has to be different from one class to another. There won't be a model that fits all. To that regards, it's very important to note that it is not the intention of World Sailing and of this scope of work to standardize the way in which equipment is controlled within the Olympic classes, but rather to make sure that there's a system in place that allows us to be able to ensure that they are adhered to those systems in place. Just in terms of the objective, and before I move into the timeline, the objective is to, for example, if we look into, there's been some debate as to what would happen with measurement control classes, things already included in the class rules, etc. But I think it's important, and this group knows that for measurement control classes, the quality control system would aim to ensure that for equipment items designated by the class in agreement by World Sailing and in agreement with the class, were a manufacturer is required to produce the same model and make it available for all consumers, it is built to the same specifications for everyone. So whether if it's a design that, even though it fits the rules, it commits to providing the same design and make it available to everyone. And therefore, for that, we will require to control against an agreed set of specifications for that model. And it will also mean to the scope of work would aim to have means to identify alterations to evaluate that model is actually being built towards that specification. This will require to have defined processes to approve new molds, changes to the building specifications and include deadlines as to when those changes are going to be implemented, when new models are to be allowed in relation to the Olympic cycle and period. For manufacturer control classes, the same applies, although the distinction is that the scope of work will also require to evaluate the content of the builder's manuals to, that actually World Sailing has access to, in order to develop the measurements and the tools to be able to provide our equipment inspectors with the necessary knowledge and information to be able to identify those alterations and to know if they are the result of the inherent manufacturer tolerances or if actually it's because equipment has been altered. The contracts and how we will be aiming to implement this is that the Olympic classes contracts and the commercial undertakings that we have with manufacturers of Olympic equipment have already been addressed towards having the framework for implementing this scope of work. And it will require classes to require classes to have to require through the class rules that classes implement that as a requirement that the equipment that has been defined by World Sailing and the classes needs to be approved, needs to be manufactured by a manufacturer approved by World Sailing, and they have to have a unique reference number, therefore ensuring that that equipment item has passed the quality control. It will also require to approve the evolution or changes to the specifications by World Sailing. And what we're aiming to do is to have a structured and documented management system that will provide the framework for how World Sailing will do this. What we want to do is to make sure that for the identified equipment items, we have a clear documented system where we can that we can evaluate against, that includes the tolerances, that includes the different specifications that have to be met, and also that includes what different processes of during the manufacturing process are being controlled. The way we want to do this is to include all the relevant bodies within World Sailing, the class management, the class technical committee, the builders, the athlete representatives, international measurers, the international measurers committee, so that we can work within the different scope of work items that we have, one being identifying equipment, another one being evaluating the current systems in place, another one being deciding what are the controls processes during the building system, that we take into account into the discussions the different groups and the different expertise, and then have a specific workforce for the different classes that we would be working to implement the quality control system specific to each class. The discussions around this topic within the Olympic classes subcommittee have been around how to finance and how to be able to ensure the resources towards this end. It is clear and everyone recognizes the merits of this scope of work and the process to and this alignment in the process being proposed as to working together with tailored systems that will allow to address the particular challenges of each class. The current model is built around the proposal of having a manufacturer policy fee, which is included in the contracts. That was proposed to be covered by a fixed fee, not more than 1%, that would be covered by the manufacturers, that would allow to have a budget for every equipment item within every class. What we have decided is to make sure that we can provide to the classes and the manufacturers a overview of the scope that we intend to deliver for every class, including a forecast of the budget and a forecast of the cost, so that we can consider alternative methods to finance that work. And there's been an alignment and an agreement towards this proposed timeline by which this year, what's remaining of this year, we will be working closely with the classes to have a draft operational plan overview so that we can consult and then agree early in the beginning of the year on a way to finance this the work. What has been relevant and what is being appreciated by everyone is that this brings on quite an administrative task, that it's a new scope of work and that resources have to be found. The board in the past has mentioned that they don't consider this to have to come from the general budget, and therefore the classes and the manufacturers will need to be able to come up to with an agreement with World Sailing as to how we'll be delivering this piece of work. What we aim to do is to put that operational plan overview for the discussions and then agree on a financial model, and then be able to implement this work ahead of 2020, at the end of the Olympics, so that we have something ready. And we wanted to stress the urgency, because it's obviously important to start addressing this before the campaign for 2024 starts, Lina. And hopefully everyone has read the document and there's an alignment on the merits of it, just to present the timeline that we are working towards.
Wonderful. Great. Thank you. Does anybody have some questions or comments for Jaime? This is ongoing work. You have received documentation on this as supporting papers, but it is pretty important. If we can limit our conversation, great. If you have questions, please speak up. Otherwise, both Jaime and I have been working on this extensively, and if you have suggestions or comments, you can always email them to us and we will take them on board. I think I have everything that's coming in the chat available to me. So I think there are no questions for you, Jaime. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dina. The next point, if I just jump quickly onto it, is following these discussions that we've been having with all the classes and the working party, is become relevant that we also offer and address the control of one design equipment among all those classes that actually use or consider themselves to be using one design equipment. And we have produced a charter that sets out the principles and best practices towards what classes could be doing. And if the aim is to ensure that through class associations and manufacturer, that World Sailing can support the wider implementation of one design policies and best practice. And it's an invitation to the classes to gather all the requirements that they consider are relevant to ensure the integrity of their class from an equipment perspective. World Sailing could approve those policies if they comply with the minimum requirements from World Sailing, and it would allow the classes to make sure that they are reporting compliance with it, and World Sailing to be able to communicate that there's a system in place. So it's an invitation to classes to review this. It's been presented in a draft form, and we are going to follow up with a survey to gather feedback within the classes following these meetings.
Thank you, Jaime. Does anybody have any comments about that? It's a pretty thorough document, but like we said, it's draft, and we're going to submit it, or we're going to circulate it for comment. Great.
Jaime, this has been circulated to the equipment committee and all the committees. Yeah. It will be now. There will be a survey for the classes.
Are there any other comments or questions for Jaime? Wonderful. Okay, next on our agenda is our parasailing report. Brian Todd, over to you.
Report. And we basically are just talking about some of the boats that are involved in our championship and grade one events. Obviously 2020 was a slow year, but there have been a few events at the local level where boat testing has been done. I think it's important to note that in the para group, we've had the Hansa 303 and the RS Venture Connect as boats that are provided at events by the manufacturer they're chartered to the competitors. This has reduced the cost of obviously boat transportation for the competitors, but also the overall cost for competitors. And it has worked out very well. I think it's a model that should be looked at in some of the other classes, that it would be very effective. That was the highlight on that part. On the 2.4, there has been some issues with the 2.41 design, and the 2.4 meter class has now put together a subcommittee that has working on refining the 2.41 design rule and trying to integrate it into the overall 2.4 class, so that both at competitions and within that 2.4 class, it can be more effective. So they're the ones that have initiated at this time, and they recognize that the 2.41 design is an integral part of their program. So hopefully that can work out so that it can get World Sailing designation to be a class within a class. We've done a little bit of equipment evaluation. The SV14 is a new two-person boat that has come out. A couple of the sailors, there are 10 boats in Germany and 10 in the Netherlands, a couple of sailors, Jens Kroger and Heiko Kroger, have taken on the task of testing the SV14 in a variety of conditions and competition scenarios. Results at this point are not complete, but both testers are encouraged by the sailing properties of the boat. And there'll be more information coming on that as we go along. So basically, that's my report on Paraworld Sailing.
Great. Brian, I do have one question for you, because do you feel that the one design 2.4 meter is making progress with the international class? Because I have had communication from, I believe it's the US representative that's the secretary of the class, that he was getting a lot of pushback. Are you telling me that that seems to have smoothed out?
As a matter of fact, over this past summer, we had a meeting with that person and several other persons in North America. They were concerned that the 2.4 meter one design was being kind of shuffled off to the side. We addressed this with the 2.4 class, and this is when they decided to set up this subcommittee to look at how the 2.41 design can be integrated into the regular class. So yes, it is being worked on now. As a matter of fact, I've had pages of information over the last few days discussing this topic and trying to come up with a process of solidifying the one design rules so that old boats, new boats can be used and made to be as one design as possible.
Great. I'm happy to hear it. Thank you very much. Anybody else have any questions for Brian? Cool. Good luck with your boat testing. I think it's great that there's another piece of equipment that's looking to support parasailing. All right. I think we're ready to move into our executive office reports. You have supporting papers for in-house certification, the class status review, and to note that the Laser 2 Class Association has asked to be dropped from World Sailing's international classes. Jaime, can I turn over to you and Francesco?
Idina, Hendrik will cover the IAC report.
Great. Hendrik, it's up to you.
Hi, just briefly, so there has been a report distributed as supporting paper. It's uploaded at the website. generally speaking, there hasn't been a lot of progress due to the COVID-related travel restrictions this year, so it wasn't possible to audit any loft, neither in Europe or in Asia. Apart from that, we still sold like 8,000 stickers, which is about 2,000 less than the year before. Looking at the current situation, I think that's a really good result. I think that's from my side. If you have any questions regarding the report, just ask.
Great, thank you very much. Everybody has the report. So if you have questions, please email Henrik or Jaime and get that answered. Jaime, is Francesco going to present the class annual report summary?
Yes, Francesco, if you're still here, yes, I think so.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Jaime. Thank you. Thank you, Dina. Can you hear me?
Yes, we've got you.
Okay, hi, everyone. So as you all know, every year, we ask the classes to complete and send an annual report to the office, and we require this information to, of course, ensure transparency, but also to evaluate compliance with World Sailing Regulations. So this year, the office implemented a new system to facilitate the completion of the reports, and we try to include as much pre-filled information as possible and to reduce the data requested. This new system has also facilitated the analysis of the information provided by the classes. And since World Sailing Regulation requires that the equipment committee reviews classes at least every 3 years, it will help the committee to select and review the classes. The office prepared a summary review as supporting paper, which shows a list of information that has been included in the annual reports. And in this case, it is important to know that the highlighted information does not necessarily mean that the regulations are not met. However, due to the particular challenges of this year, we did not compile information relative to events, and we will aim to include this information in the next reports. So what we think is that the equipment committee should set up a working party to review the class status. However, due to the short notice, we will request that any review will take place in 2021. So Jaime, please feel free to add any comments.
Thank you, Francesco. Now that was very clear. As you saw, we just compiled the information and provided it in a table form. It shows what classes have reported and is missing. So it's based on their own report. It is important to note that a few areas have been addressed through submissions actually put forward this year in relation to IMs, but more or less it provides a good starting point for the equipment committee to select which classes it should review, which actually, as per the regulations, the equipment committee should be reviewing every class at least once every 3 years. So Dina, if the committee has any questions, we'll be happy to answer.
Great, thank you. Does anyone have any questions about the class report? Wonderful. Okay. I think we've noted the dropping of the laser 2, and I think we can move into our sustainability. I don't know if Dan's here with us or not.
No, just to comment before we move on that, we have this slide and it's just for your information so that everyone understands how we work in terms of plaques. The image in the screen just shows the plaques that have been issued by World Sailing during 2019. It's important to note that this does not necessarily reflect the boats that have been built, because we operate and we have different agreements with all the different classes. We've got 119 classes and different agreements with each one of them. In some cases, the class acts as issuing plaques on our behalf. In others, we issue plaques directly to the class ourselves, and in other cases, we issue directly to the manufacturers ourselves. So sometimes classes order in bulk and then they use what they have from previous years. There's also a few classes that use different systems, like registration of equipment, like the IKA does, or the boards, the windsurfing boards, and therefore that's not reflected here. But just to show the information that is also within World Sailing. The number of boats built each year can be found in each class specific annual report. For the sustainability, Dan apologized and he asked me just to note that the sustainability agenda actually, as we are aware, includes some recommendations for with different targets that affect different operational areas within World Sailing, one of them being the technical standards. And just to highlight that for the following years and the review processes that we will do within events and equipment, it's important to note that there are certain commitments within the sustainability agenda that we will need to consider when we review and select equipment, such as, for example, the one that on the bottom right, third point from the bottom, says require that 90% of a boat by weight is recyclable for new Olympic classes selected for 2028. So there are things that we will need to take into account and we will need to consider in our processes, Lina.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And we'll point out that even though we were ahead of the requirement, we did look at sustainability when we were evaluating and selecting the foiling windsurfing equipment. And the manufacturer Starboard has a very robust system and support of sustainability agenda items. Okay. Jaime, this is this report from the executive was something that we touched upon at the very beginning of our meeting yesterday, but so I don't want to skip it. So please discuss the scope of work that you believe the office has and try to address what impacts you believe have are going to come out of this COVID situation and how we can help make everything better.
Okay, well, just as background, what I prepared for the classes committee, it was an update of the scope of work for the technical committee from the technical and offshore team for everyone's benefit. And as you know, I think it's important to note that the World Sailing's core mission, which is to make sailing more exciting and accessible for everyone, and also to use our reach and influence to create a sustainable future. Within our team, in addition to that, we aim to promote safety and fairness in the competition. Obviously, that's through controlling and certifying equipment, and also to regulate equipment and its use at events. And we obviously are very close to promoting the technical aspect of the sport and the technology and the forces that power the equipment. And of course, to then service the members and the classes. Within that, then we look into providing our supports to this committee, also the Equipment Rules Subcommittee, the International Measures Subcommittee to an extent, and also the Oceanic and Offshore Committee, the Special Regulations Committee, and the International Regulations Commission, and of course the World Sailing Classes Committee. And in most cases for this committees, but also for the classes, we are the first point of contact in World Sailing with the classes and the manufacturers, and we provide administrative and technical services. We manage the new class applications, we manage the class rule changes, the class rule interpretations, the annual reports, and the issue of plaques. And we manage the offshore special regulations structural plan review, liaison with the notified bodies. We also manage the in-house certification scheme, as you saw, training and auditing lofts, and the licensing of new manufacturers, and the approval processes for new building specifications. And then we provide support at World Sailing events when and also assist the international measures at those events. Then, like in previous years, recently, we've also organized the sea trials when needed for the selection of Olympic equipment, and we provide our assistance to the Olympic classes in inspecting their manufacturers and implementing best practices. Also, next year, it's important to note that we also aim to assist the technical committee for the Tokyo event. And this year, obviously, I would like to thank everyone with the assistance during our furlough that we have been unable to, we've only been able to provide limited assistance and have had to delay a few of our services. But many of you and other volunteers have stepped up to form working parties to help us in those areas. For 2021, we will focus, obviously, inevitably, to deliver Tokyo 2021. Technical deliverables, assisting the technical committee for the of that event, also with the invitation to tender that we for the offshore equipment that we saw and that we discussed, also with the updates to the regulation 23. Then also monitoring the implementation of the Olympic equipment policy will be a priority, and there's manufacturers obviously that are very affected and want to see progress on that side. We will also aim to progress the One Design equipment policies and the charter that has been proposed and put forward to classes, and the World Sailing Quality Control System for the Olympic equipment. We will obviously look into providing and more awareness within safety equipment, and we will plan to streamline the services that we are currently providing from an administrative side. And the other items, the sustainability agenda, as has been mentioned, and then continue to connect the technical industry, Dina. So this is what we foresee as the scope of work for the technical team for next year. In relation to furlough and everything, obviously, in the UK, the furlough system is still active. It will be a discussion with the next board what will need to happen there. But obviously, there is work to be done for sure. And there will be a need for volunteers and assistance moving forward.
Thank you, Jaime. I think everyone should appreciate how big a list you've been able to present. I do want to note to everyone that we were just introduced to Francesco a little while ago. He is the newest member of our technical team. So welcome, Francesco. Now we know we all know what you look like.
Thank you, Dina. Thank you for the intro. And hi everyone, nice to meet you.
Sorry, yeah. Dina, obviously the introductions through email have been made. It's true that It's the first time you see his face. Good.
That's right. So now I know what he looks like. So it won't be when I remember the first time I met you, Jaime. I walked by you twice before I realized that's who you were. So so now I'll know. Does anybody have any questions or comments about Jaime's presentation of the scope of work for next year for the office? I think it's important to see that there's the other feeling of urgency that I'm feeling about the invitation to tender for the offshore equipment is, as the year goes on, the technical office is going to be distracted by the Olympic Games and have more and more work to do. So I do mean to move on that invitation very, very quickly after this meeting. I believe our term really doesn't end till January 1st. So although I don't know who will still be in the equipment committee or even if I will be the chair, I think I will still try to make some progress so that I leave something available to the next committee. So anybody wants to volunteer to help me, Jorgen, you can be sure I will be contacting you to at least review some of the documents. Thank you very much. We are now moving into our other business. Bill Abbott has requested us to consider something with the Etchells class. So I'd like to turn the floor over to Bill.
Thank you, Dina. As was shown, that I passed on a request from the president of the International Lectures class that the equipment committee form a working party to decide the aspects of the molds and plugs that are currently being used in the class. The Etchells is an old class. It's been around from the days of the IYRU through ISAF and now to World Sailing. The class was intended to be a single source but multi-builder class. It's controlled by the source of the plugs and the molds and checked by the templates, the class templates. Through the years, the plugs have been rejuvenated. They had started with original, and then they made a new plug back in the 70s, referred to as plug number two, of which there were three molds made, which I had sent around to everybody, the timing of such. But then the class started to worry about, after 2000, that the lifetime of plugs, the deterioration, might be happening. So they decided to scan plug number two and the three bolts from the three different molds to come up with a data, scan data that would represent the hull shape of the Etchells. They didn't eliminate plug number two. It was still there, still in existence, but it is, they had hoped to use scan data so it would not deteriorate. There was a request to build another mold, and the class decided that the scan data would be used to build that other mold. There was some discussion of which this is before my time, so I'm just relating what I realized about the history. Some expected the mold would be cut from the data. As a boat builder, I realize you basically have to build a plug and then build a mold if you're dealing with something of this size. But the data, when it went to the country to be used, they didn't think it was good enough, so they basically scanned their own data and created a plug, which was checked from the templates. And then they had made a mold from it. Unfortunately, the plug was not checked to make sure that it was the same as the other plugs. It was just checked to see if it would fit the templates at that point. The problem that has arisen is that it has been discovered that the boat is a different shape than the original plug. The mold and technically has not been registered with World Sailing. World Sailing didn't know about it. And so that it's the class through its voting, the powers that the governors and stuff have said that it's not illegal, and they've requested the builder to stop building. In the meantime, the National Association had said, well, if we're not legal, then all the original ones, 8, 9, and 10, are not legal. Because of either World Sailing or IYRU or ISAF at the time not okaying them. It's at an impasse. It's at an impasse between the governors and the National Association in regards to the responsibilities of World Sailing, responsibilities of the international class back and forth. And to go through it, you have to go back through all of the data and look at the responsibility that World Sailing took on, or at that time the IYRU, when they took the original, took over the responsibility of the Etchells from Skip Etchells, and also the responsibility of who looks after the builders and how the builders are supplied their molds or plugs. That's all to do with World Sailing and their part of their responsibility. So, that I'm trying to get into why we need World Sailing with the Equipment Committee to have this working party to decide this. I'm trying to avoid specifics because they should only be brought out by the working party. Some of it is documents with contracts with World Sailing and builders, contracts with the class, contracts between World Sailing and Skip Etchells. But all of this, because of coming over from an older time to now, it's all relevant and needs to be considered. There is a lot of data. There are reports. There's been studies. There's been speed evaluation studies from the scanning. All of it that is there for somebody to look at and apprise. I'm not going to comment on that, but I will comment on one thing, and that is when I became the measure of the Etchells class, I started to see differences, measurable differences that I could not explain. And I've been for 4 or 5 years trying to get to the bottom of it. And just in this past year, it was revealed why there are differences. And that's because the original scan data wasn't used when they made this newer boat. But the working party really needs to decide on the validity of the original molds and plugs. Have they been followed? And if those rules, if they're valid, then then you can move on to the last question of mold 11. It's not just class rules. It's not just in the governor's committee of the Etchells. This involves the relationship of World Sailing and the Etchells class, and that's why we need the working party.
Great. Thank you for that overview. So basically, we need to form a group that's willing to take a look at this. They are an international class and they have come to World Sailing and asked for our help. The technical staff at World Sailing will help us, but I don't believe that they should be left with this on their own. So we represent the technical experts at World Sailing. There are many of us who are international measurers. There are many of us who work in contracts. Many of us that have measured a lot of prototype boats as well as measured finished product. So first I will respond that I will be happy to be part of a working party, that I would like to get volunteers from this group who feel they are qualified to do this. If you're an international measurer, if you have measured prototype equipment, and if you have interest in doing this and assisting myself and the office, then I would ask you to volunteer. Yes, Jaime, you may speak.
Thank you, Dina. I think it would be very important to have a clear defined terms of reference for the working party and to make sure that those are within the terms of reference of the equipment committee. I think obviously there's benefit on having expertise and the different expertise of this group being able to assist. What needs to be clear is what the request is to make sure that we are not addressing areas that are currently covered within processes of regulations or other areas. If the class were to be asking for a class rule interpretation as to our boats, are certain boats class complying with the class rules, that will require a formal request for a class rule interpretation, and the process is defined in the regulation. So we just need to make sure that depending on what the request is and the scope of work is, that this is actually the best way to address it. So I do think, and maybe this is something that still needs to be, I'm not sure if it's already been considered, but clearly within the conversations that we've had already in the office, there's been a lot of areas to evaluate this. As Bill said, that there's many documentation going on, many conversations going on. One thing is to evaluate the performance of equipment. Another thing is to evaluate whether if those hulls would qualify now to be considered within the rules, whether the mold could be approved now, etc. It will be required that to know what the questions are very clearly set up to make sure that we're not doing things.
I agree with you, Jaime, but I think that from the email traffic that I've seen, this first working party's question is to consider the if molds 8, 9, and 10 are are valid molds accepted and were brought into the class in a legal manner. Correct, Bill?
That's correct. Yeah, that's correct. And that's the spanning of times. And it actually does involve almost everything that Jaime has stated, except that he mentioned just the hulls. And if the hulls are there, class legal. But it's because the class rules also deal with the builders and the molds and how the molds have been provided, which is in the contracts, it's involved in more than just the hulls. It is class rules, but it's also class specifications, which is outside of those rules, and it's also in the contracts. And Jaime, to answer your question, I think what needs to happen is a decision first of this one simple thing, and then it can be redefined to move forward. And that's a core issue, and that involves, I know, the office, but also the equipment committee itself, because it's going to get into one design policies of which you were talking about for a lot of the old classes. We're going to have the same thing that's going to come up.
Yes.
Okay.
So to clarify, Dina, just to clarify, certainly from the office, what we can help the class is with specific questions as to if the class agreements are met, whether if class rules are being adhered to, and if the class knows what they want to do moving forward, we can obviously help working to update the class agreements to that end or implement any class rule change that has been duly addressed to make sure that things moving forward are covered. Anything else obviously will depend on the available resources to make sure that we can contribute to.
Yes, and because I don't think there's a lot of resources, to get some other experienced eyes onto these documents is the reason to form the working party. They're very sensitive documents. They're not able to be distributed worldwide, and I think we need to have a small group that has volunteered to participate in this activity. Barry Johnson, you have a question?
I've got a few, to be honest with you. The first question I'm going to ask is, how long have we known of these anomalies or perceived anomalies? And in asking that question, has it only been kept to certain members of the equipment committee? And if so, why?
So we have only known about the discussions going on in the Etchells committee for about the last 2 months. And I believe that besides Bill and I and some questions that were put to the office, they're the only people who knew about it. And I was asked not to distribute any of the information I received by the class. So I was not really acting as the equipment committee chair. I was acting as Dina Coalition International Measurer.
For the Etchell class?
Yep. Well, I'm not an international measure for the Etchells class. I'm just an international measurer who happens to be acquainted. But as it escalated, it became clear to me that it was something that was not an interpretation I felt comfortable certainly making myself, and that bringing other experts into the activity was going to be required. And so then I put my equipment committee hat on and said, we are the technical experts at World Sailing who are here to support our international classes. And
okay.
Does that, are there more questions?
Yeah, I've got, yeah.
Okay.
From what information we've received and from Bill's summation just a few seconds ago, a few minutes ago, this looks like it's going to be a highly political and I put on a bit of a law hat here. I say it could be in the courts before we know what's happened, correct?
Well, I'm hopeful that that isn't the case, but yes.
Correct or not correct?
I mean, that could happen. It could happen with anything.
Okay.
Maybe I could answer that for Barry. Barry, one of the sides has obviously claimed that we will take this to court. And so that is one of the reasons the dispute has escalated up to the position it is right now. And to get some of the answers and through people that have been here for a while was to get this and help move these things along that way.
Okay, so how many hull plaques have been issued? I've just been making some notes, that's all, and I'm just asking the questions.
How many hull plaques have been issued ever
for these folks that are supposedly not compliant?
Okay, so Barry, you're referring to the last mold that we're talking about there. Well,
I don't know, because there's which said that molds 8, 9, and 10, there was a problem with them, and there's a problem with mold 11. So that's 4 molds.
Well, the fact that the class has said that mold 11 isn't legal, and the people that own mold 11 have come back and said, well, if we're not, then 8, 9, and 10 are not legal. That probably covers about 1,000 votes. The votes that are from the last mold, number 11, is, from what I believe right now, 27, perhaps 28 votes. I think, does that answer your question?
Okay, well, thank you for that. Where are all these molds located?
It's in my report that went around to you, but 8 is in Ontario Yachts, which is in Ontario, Canada. 9 was Pacesetter in Australia, that I understand that they destroyed. Number 10 mold is in David Heritage's, which is in Cowes, England.
Okay.
And number 11, to keep it everything open, wide open, number 11 is in Australia and NARA.
Okay. Well, if we're going to have a working party, I'd support it on the condition that it's global and it's not just centered on, in this case, it looks like Australia.
So Barry, that making it global and getting outside information is exactly why I encourage the Etchells class to make this request of the equipment committee.
My thing was, I would support it as long as it was global.
Yep. Nope, no problem there.
Okay. And what are we going to do with all the boats that are not legal?
Well, I think that's beyond this working party. I think until we figure out what's happening with the molds and answer the questions that the International Etchells class is asking, I don't want to suppose anything else.
Well, I'm asking because, as a member of the equipment committee, it's going to come back and reflect on us eventually. We've got a working party.
Well, it's not really our decision. It's the International Etchells class decision whether they ask to grandfather those boats in or ask.
Well, you're asking to set up a working party from the equipment committee at the request of the Etchells class
to investigate their molds.
Where does the responsibility lie? The responsibility will lie then back with the working party. It has to.
Yes, Jorgen, you can ask a question. I don't think I'm getting Barry.
Just a quick one. Taking all these points, I see the importance of this to be dealt with. I'm still not convinced that this should be an equipment committee working party. What I mean is the following. Taking into account, when you look at the different classes around the world, a lot of this is dealt with in technical committees of the class itself. And I was just wondering whether it would not be an option to get, let's say, an Etchells class working party inside their technical committee organization that still can attract external experts, rather than have it under the umbrella of the equipment committee directly.
So, Jorgen, to answer your question, they actually have already done that, and their report wasn't really accepted or acted on, and I think Bill can explain that a little further.
That has been done, as Dina stated. And what we end up with is regional problems between different regions. And so even though it was an international group, because one area doesn't have as many members on the committee as the other, then they won't accept that. And it's varying, disputed. There's no doubt. And the One Design Technical Committee brought their recommendations to the ETCL's governing committee after looking at everything. And to be honest, the committee originally tried to check everything to be inclusive, to bring everybody together. But the more data that they found out about, the more stuff that was done, they found it that they couldn't be together. And that was presented then via our constitution to the governors of the ETCL's class, who have been through a vote, and all of that is there to be given to the group. And I can tell you that the governors voted to ask the builder to suspend building, which was done a year ago almost now, to just as it was trying to get resolved. And they're to the point now where they're actually saying, and I'll use the word, it's Australia, you can have your mold and only race in Australia and not race in the rest of the world. This is not a good thing for an international class.
Well, it's not good for sailing.
Exactly. I absolutely agree with you, and I am very sensitive to your questions, and if I could answer them very clearly, I could probably, we not have to have this group, but this is a very difficult question, and what's being, part of it's being called is the fact that World Sailing has not looked after their responsibilities, and I personally, I believe they have, but it needs to be looked at by people other than me about this. And it involves past. It involves past practices, the wording of things from the 80s and the 90s, the intents of this. I think it, once good people look at it, it will be very clear, and it will stop a lot of stuff and lead it to, for us to move on, and actually for the ETCL's class itself, those experiences maybe and lessons that can be learned can be passed on to what's going to happen with the One Design equipment policies.
I don't want to continue harp on about it or anything, but can you tell me, when were the scans done?
There were
scans. They've been repeatedly done, and the first time the equipment committee was shown the scans, I believe, was back in the early 2000s. I looked through my records for the ETCL's class, and I found a report of their initial scans, I believe, in 2008 at the equipment committee.
12 years ago.
Yep.
If I may.
And since that time, scan data has been used to verify boats that have been produced from a mold that World Sailing had never been informed existed. Mm-hmm. So well, I think we either need to say we are willing as an equipment committee to volunteer our time to help the ETCL's class, or we're not, because we're starting to get into areas where we cannot openly discuss.
No, I think this is an equipment committee, and we have the right to ask questions as individuals of this committee. And as I say, I've got no idea what the hell's going on, because I don't sail an ETCL. I haven't sailed an ETCL for over 20 years, and I hardly ever see any down here on the river anyway, because they sell Saturday mornings. And if I do see them, only when I'm going for a walk.
So this is a live meeting that's being broadcast, so I cannot discuss this further.
Dina, if I may, I think Barry...
Okay, I won't say any more.
Thank you. I think it's important to note that World Sailing will react with whatever it's requested to do. But if we are requested to evaluate whether if a boat or a series of boats are class legal, there's a process for that request, and it will require to include within the group for consultation the Equipment Rules Subcommittee and follow the processes within our regulations. If we are being requested to address whether if a manufacturer is complying with a class agreement, we will be able to address that. The requests have to be specific and have to be directed from the class. If the class is asking that we evaluate hulls and see how they compare to other hulls, we can provide advice towards that specific service, which is obviously out of our current scope of work and services that we provide, but we'll be more than happy to assist. But we need to know, obviously, the detailed request towards each end. Also, it's worth noting that our regulations require to review the classes, and part of the review of the classes is to note whether if the systems that they have in place continue to address and control the equipment within their that they control. So that is something also that is part of the responsibilities of the class, and there's processes in our regulations on how to address the class's means to control their equipment. If we are being asked to update the class agreements or the class rules to adopt and grandfather equipment, we would be able to address that particular request. But the direction has to come from the class, that's my understanding, or from a working party or from a group of experts. But it won't be able to come from World Sailing which direction should be taken. World Sailing has to be instructed as to what the class wishes to do, and then we'll be able to look into how to implement class rules approved by the class, how to implement changes to the class agreements, etc. We will obviously be able to and willing to put forward our time and assist everyone, but we won't be able to direct on how things should be happening moving forward for the class.
And I don't think that that's the question that's been asked of us. I think everybody understands what World Sailing's role here is. So basically, the class is asking for some experts to form a working party to help them with their conflict. And they approached the equipment committee to look for those experts, because we have representation from the international measures and the equipment rules of sailing, et cetera, et cetera. I asked, Bill brought this forward to see if anyone was willing to volunteer. If no one's willing to volunteer.
I'm happy.
So Jaime's willing to volunteer. I've said I'm willing to volunteer.
As an IM, I am
willing to volunteer. Is there anyone else willing to volunteer? Okay, so Australian Sailing has messaged Barry to say that they would like to assist in this matter and that I should contact Glenn, so I will do that.
I would be part of the group, but I you understand my position as being the manager of the Etchells.
I do understand that's why you've reached out, and I think there are other people within World Sailing that might be interested, and I think we will continue to solicit to come up with at least 3 or 4 members here. And I can't, you know, I can't ask anything more.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. Are you satisfied, Bill, that we've dealt with this, your business?
Yes, I am. I think that it'll move forward to what we need, and that maybe some other people, and that's on this group, which, because there are other measures to be involved, most likely, and there's also We might, after some discussion, maybe, you know, ask Jürgen to be involved after chats with various reasons as well. So it's very quick to decide this. So I think you've covered this really well, and we can just move it forward after this.
Wonderful. Okay. Does anybody else have any other business to bring forward at this time?
I have sent a message that I didn't get a response on. If I could have one last chat on this matter.
Yes, Barry. Yeah.
The message from Australian Sailing, I will read to you. We, Australian Sailing, need to be involved in this. Please let the working or the equipment committee know we're in and can help resource the working party with independent, skilled people. Too political with a class locally. Tell them to contact me, Glenn Stenaway.
Yep. Wonderful. Thank you very much for that. Okay. Well, I think that concludes our meeting. It's been a pleasure to work with all of you for the last 4 years. I wish you good luck going forward and smooth sailing. I consider you all to be friends. Please feel free to reach out to me at any time. And thank you for your continued efforts for World Sailing. Does anyone have any further comments?
Thank you, Dina.
Been a great 4 years. We'll see what happens next.
Thanks, Dana.
I'll be at council on whenever the council meeting is. If anybody's listening in, I hope I represent us well. So.
Thanks, Dana.
To see some of us on the race course instead of across the table.
Thank you.
Yep.
We're just closing the meeting now, okay?
Yes, we're going to close the meeting now. Thank you, Jaime.
Recording has stopped.